So what I'm going to do is my standard intro. I'm going to say hello, everybody, you know, introduce myself briefly. And I always let my guests introduce themselves because I think nobody could really talk better about you than you. Hence the first question on that thing, the list I sent you earlier.
So yeah, the one I skimmed over because I prefer the surprise. Yeah. I always hate when people are like, and here's my guest, and I'm like, I don't know what I'm supposed to fucking say.
Yeah. Like, yeah, I make it simple. It's like, you know, and my guest today, well, I always let you introduce yourself. Who are you and what do you do? That's always my first question. So,
and then I feel like a fucking asshole because I'm just like, hello, I'm this prick from the internet. Yeah. By the way, we've already started. You don't need to, we're already live now. No, I'm serious. We're doing it.
All
like
right,
this.
Cool. So I'm gonna do my formal introduction after we've already started. Hello, everyone. This is Stanpai here today with a very special guest, another conversation here on my series of conversations. And as I like to say, who are you and what do you do?
Hello. I'm telling you, you're going to feel like a fucking idiot every time.
Dude, do it, Joe.
Yeah. Hey, what's up? It's Mountain Dew. If you don't know me, that's good.
So, with his great humility, Mountain Dew here is a brand of soda. It's delicious, highly caffeinated, not good for your teeth, but overall kind of a kick in the ass when you're down. But the man on the other side of the microphone today is an otoMAD maker, ytpmv'er. And for those who don't know what those words are, well, welcome to my channel. I'm sure I've introduced them a few times here. But you make videos and really funny things for the internet, I think, is the most basic way to describe what you do.
I suppose I make whatever the hell I feel like at the time, and that's kind of it, right?
Yeah. Like, otherwise, you just stop doing it.
Yeah, kind of. Well, I mean, I kind of already have, huh?
Sure as hell not in it for the money.
Everyone thinks I am. It's great.
Dude, well, you know, aside from like maybe minor branding and clothing and stuff, which really isn't anything other than just, hey, you want to get in on this, you know, it's really not like, no, how could anybody legitimately monetize that entire genre of content? It just doesn't.
Who can monetize anything on YouTube? YouTube. Who makes money on YouTube?
Oh, man. So, yeah, that's probably a really good segue into just what this entire thing is going to be mostly about, which is that very special kind of content, otoMADs and YTPMVs and all that stuff, and just you as a creator. So for those listening who don't know what an otoMAD is, the layman's definition would probably be easiest to describe as audio and visual content mixed together in a very creative way where you transform what would essentially be, you know, a normal scene in a show or a normal song or sound bites from different things and find a way to creatively blend them together.
Wow. You made that sound way more complicated than it actually is. Oh, imagine if you took a fart sound and you made it sing Twinkle Twinkle Little Star.
That's otoMAD. So there you go.
I wish I was right. Like, yeah, right. Well, you can't get any more. You can't get easier than that.
Yeah, pitch shifting and creating beautiful melodies of farts, spanking, and who knows what else. So, I mean, in your case, when did you start working in this genre of content? Like, when did you first? You started with YTPMV or otoMAD?
Oh God, I don't know. I don't know what I would consider what I started with. God. Well, when I first started, it was 2009 or 2010. So we're approaching on 10 years. It might have been in earlier as well, honestly, now that I think about it. I've been around a long time. And I'm trying to remember some of the first things I played around with. You know, it could have been Gotchi and it could have been Old Spice. It's hard to tell.
And what made you start doing that? Like, how did you get introduced to all this stuff?
I was hoping you're going to ask this question because I love the story on this. I got introduced from otoMAD. So otoMAD definitely was the first introduction for me. But I don't know if I started with a Western source or a Japanese source. Mm-hmm. But it was actually on 4chan on the Flashboard. Mm. I remember very clearly, you know, some of them were, they just uploaded like the Ronald McDonald ones. The first, my first exp- I can actually tell you my first exposure to gachi 100%, which is the Gourmet Race gachi video. And because people, they would do a bait and switch on F, which I don't even know if that's a board anymore. But it would be a bait and switch there. And I would watch it, and I was like, this is the craziest fucking thing I've ever seen. I love this. This is my aesthetic of insanity, you know. And I was, you know, at that time, 18, 17, to give you an idea of how old I am.
No, I something don't like that. Tell.
Yeah. And I was like, wow, this is crazy. I love this. And, you know, I kind of played around with that, and I was doing live streams with some people. So I was playing around with editing for them, and I started fucking around and making videos, and, you know, the kind of rest is a very long history.
You got me, Nana. So for you as a creator, what medium did you, I guess, what was your, like, your first skill set? You know, because it's parts audio, visual, and everything in between. What were you doing first? Like, were you an audio maker? Were you a visual maker? And then what skills did you pick up as you worked there on these different things?
God, we're going to have a fun conversation. I'm excited for this one, man. So it's hard to say with... if we're talking just otoMAD in general, I mean, I was the, you know, the Sony Vegas, so you kind of have both at the same time. So, if we're going to talk about anything I did before I even touched video editing, you know, I did 3D work. You know, I did level design for Half-Life 1 and Half-Life 2 for fun. And my entire life, I was an artist, give or take, on one thing or another. I've always wanted to tell this story, and I'm really, really, really happy that we can actually visit
it. It's finally time.
It's a very, very light, it's quick and easy, but I remember that I went full circle with one of the memes that I fuck with. I guess I can curse, right? I
hope. Oh yeah, so. Go feel free.
I've been on other ones like, you can't. I'm like, oh no.
Too bad.
That was a panel. They're like, you can't say bad words. I'm like, oh, okay. I hope no one's in this room when I'm in it. I used to play around with audio when I was a kid. And when I say I was a kid, I'm saying like 7, 8 years old.
Right.
And I learned that you can turn a pair of headphones into a microphone.
Yeah.
If you plug it into the mic slot and yell into it,
Try real hard.
And we're talking, this is cassette days, man. And I remember... I recorded a fake radio show with my friend, and like I said, we're like 7, 8 years old, so we're dumb as hell. But it was I wanted to convince my mom that they were saying bad words on the radio. Of course, my mom didn't care. But we were like, yeah, you know, blah blah blah, fuck you, radio, you know, blah blah blah. But we were recording on cassette, and the way cassette works is, you know, you can hit play and then rewind slightly and then record over it. And do, so you can cut into it.
You can splice.
It's linearly. Yeah. And so we did that, and I cut into it, and I shit you not, because at the time, The Chronic 2001 was like my favorite album. We're like, yeah, you know, weed radio, blah, blah, blah. And then like, I swear on my life. And I was like 8 years old, and this was in like 2002 or something. I spliced in the smoke weed every day soundbite. And I remember it so clearly, and I wish I had it somehow. But it was so funny, and I always think about it now. It's like this weird full circle of like, we're like 20 years ago kind of stuff. I'm not saying like I started a meme or anything, but I just like, how did this happen? Like 10 years before the joke started.
You made your destiny in that moment. You know,
it was. I realized it like 5 years ago, and I was like, what the hell?
Obama 4.
Yeah, exactly.
That's awesome, dude. Hell? So I mean, audio was really the first thing you ever really played around with then, as far as like the three main skills that go into these kind of videos.
Audio definitely was first, because my mother got me a keyboard, and so I fucked around the keyboard. I took some lessons, but I would never call myself a musician, even now. I took lessons for piano, but I wasn't good at piano, and I'm still not good at piano/keyboard, and I have no music talent whatsoever. But like, that was definitely the first, and that kind of art went, you know, through my life here and there, where I think there was nothing really going on. And then I started graffiti as a kid or teenager, which has some hilarious stories And then, you know, during that time as well, I was doing all the 3D like hammer level design, and I messed around with 3D and had like a little bit of 3D knowledge, and I went to college, the first college I went to, and dropped out, and I'm glad I did. And that was the time then, right around that time, the exact time is when I started otoMAD at the same time too, because I was learning 3D software, and I was also messing around on a stream and having fun video editing, etc. And that was 2000. See, that might have been honestly like 2008, 2009. So it might have been even longer than I thought. Oof.
You don't even like put the dots together initially. Like, damn it, you really you started with a Snoop, Snoop on the cassette tape, really.
Yeah. Now that I think about it, it was probably 2008, because I remember Ask Weekend 2009 very clearly when it came out. So I've been at it probably 12 years.
How's that feel?
Like, I've wasted my life.
No. Oh
What do you
man.
do for a living, shithost?
Right.
You
Yeah,
have so
so
many skills, no.
yeah, well, I mean, I guess that's a good question. What do you do for a living?
I'm mostly freelance. It's fun, I guess. I'm my own boss, which is also horrible. I work in games, whatever the hell comes my way. Games, freelance for this and that. It pays the bills, kind of. Probably gonna move into more studio work coming up, just because it's more stable. Last couple of years for me have been really, really unstable in general, just for how I am and all that. But I've hit this nice stability point in being a human being that I think it'd be a lot easier to hold something of that caliber. I mean, I somehow managed to graduate college. So yeah, you know, I could probably do the bare minimum somewhere else.
And sometimes that hurdle is like the hardest part. It's like nothing you do after the fact ends up being as difficult. Just because
It feels like that, yeah.
Well, especially with like with the arts, there it's just like go do the thing. It's a lot different than go get the grade, you know?
Yeah. I hate to say I fell into the same trope that everyone seems to fall into, where they're like, they graduate and they're like, now what? Or like, they have that period of a year or so where they're like, nothing has happened. What the hell? Like, you know, it's a trope that you hear from everyone, and I'm just like thinking about it, and I'm like, yeah, I guess that kind of happened to me too, huh?
The tropes are
And it's
rooted in
it,
reality.
yeah. And I mean, it's no one's fault, but it was, man.
That's how it goes.
Yeah, I'm just like, fuck, man, what an interesting time. I mean, the day after I graduated, I moved out,
It was
and
it.
I went from LA to Texas.
How do you feel about that choice?
I like it. Texas is my speed. It's bigger. There's less traffic. It's not kind of a hellhole. It's different. I like Texas. It's really nice.
Right on.
LA is kind of
Dame,
no soul. There's no soul.
dame. Yeah, man, the soul versus soulless meme is real
Yeah,
explicitly
there's.
on the States. Nah, that's how I feel about Florida, man. I've been to LA and they're both considered like these tropical places to be or whatever, and it's night and day.
Yeah.
It really is.
LA is nice, and I'll it'll always be my love and my second home. Or my first, you know, but like, oof. It's the kind of thing where people, you could tell they'll step all over you just to get where they want to go. It's like YouTubers. Like, YouTubers are the
And
devil.
that's why they all moved to LA.
Yeah,
Yeah.
pretty much.
Get some nice consistency there.
Yeah, it makes sense. Oof.
Shade, excellent. So what was your first otoMAD or ytpmv that you actually like that you can remember making? Do you remember your silly cassette tape, but like what was your first release in this vein of content?
Let's see if I have it.
Ooh.
So I actually don't throw anything away.
That's awesome.
I have videos that are that old.
They usually get lost between hard drives.
I've been very lucky with that, surprisingly. One of these hard drives I have is like 8 years old. Highly suggest Western Digital. They have good hard drives, at least for me. Not Seagate. Don't buy Seagate. Seagates are bad. Very, very bad.
So what was it?
I don't know. Let's take a look.
Yo, you're gonna do it by date modified?
It, I mean, it's really, really kind of thrown around. Let's see. I don't want to take too much time doing this.
So while you're looking, I guess I'll ask you a different question. Between ytpmv and otoMAD, do you see them as the same thing, or how do you distinguish them in your mind?
I absolutely do not see them as the same thing. I've had debates with people on this
Well, I
one.
think this is a good platform to do about it then. I want to hear.
I feel like they're rooted very differently. ytpmv to me is full covers. It's a no BGM, indistinguishable, like fake samples almost. And there's not a ton of inventing, and I feel like otoMAD on itself is more of a addition to a background track, and you're adding maybe not so much vocals but sentence mixing, and you're kind of enhancing or adding to existing as opposed to recreating.
I see.
That's my opinion. They're interchangeable.
To an extent.
I think they're interchangeable completely. I mean, the other, like, to me, that's what it is. If you showed me a video and didn't tell me where it was from and I couldn't tell where it was from, I would give that opinion. But if you took a MAD and said this is a YTPMV, I would not disagree with you, because they're similar enough in terms of what they are that, it to me, it also could be where it originated, whether it was YouTube or,
Japan,
Nico
Nico
Nico,
Nico,
yeah. Or, and then where do you go when it's, Billy Billy? What is it? What's it when it's there? So that's what I think, but I'm not gonna fight someone if they tell me it's different. It's like the pronunciation of my name that we started with very haphazardly. Like there's no right or wrong answer. It's what you believe in terms of what you think it is, because they're the same thing. They're basically the same thing. You're covering audio with samples, and at the end of the day, like, it's not apples to oranges, and it's like, is it drum and bass or dubstep? Like, it's fucking music. It's the end of it.
And that's actually the name thing. That was something that was off the record, but before we started, I asked because for the longest time, I used to think it was MowtenDoo, and then I heard from others it was MowtenDoo, and then now he just it's MowtenDoo, and it's just like three variations, but all true. I heard like Steve-O, when you write his name, you have to write it with a certain consistency, or he doesn't like it. It has to be a capital S and a capital O, and there
That's
has to be a
funny.
hyphen. Now you know.
Yeah, I don't know. I've had people call me Mew. And no, I see that a lot actually. Or they'll remove the O at the end, and it'll be MowtenDoo. But like,
I think
who am I
that
to
actually
give a
is what I
shit?
first thought it was originally.
Yeah, like, who am I to care? Like,
True.
what's it gonna? It's not gonna change my day. I'm not gonna sit here and cross my arms like this guy doesn't even know how to say my fucking name.
You rip your pants
Like,
off.
yeah, it's just like, why am I gonna get bent out of shape? Like, you know my name enough. Like, I say things. It's like, I don't know if you ever had a parent say a teacher's name like wrong.
I've
Do you
had
know what I'm
teachers say
talking
my
about?
name wrong every single year, but
Where it's like, oh yes, your teacher, and then they like butcher the hell out of their last name because it's crazy. Because my dad would do that really hard. That's like how it is to me. And I'm like, they read the name, they didn't read it very well. I'm not offended. That's fine with me.
Fair enough. Everyone has a different take on that, I'd say. I mean, I for me, it was frustrating after you tell them once, like if you establish it, but you've established you don't give a shit. So I mean, that's perfectly comfortable.
Yeah, I mean, I have like a learning disability, so you gotta tell me something four times before it sticks. Like,
Fair enough. So, did you figure out what your first or maybe among your first releases were?
you know what? I'm in the wrong directory. I'm looking. I'm thinking of a couple of them.
He's lost in the Valley of Souls.
I mean, some of them were on like the desktop of the other hard drive. I only have three, four hard drives. One is a 3 terabyte, which is cool. Let's see. I'm trying to remember. I think it was It wasn't the NFL theme. And some of them are better than others. And one of the sources, I don't want to say what I think one of my first sources was because it's offensive.
Sure.
Because I was a little bastard.
Right.
remember to grow up, everyone.
Yeah. You can always say sorry later.
Yeah, I definitely have some starter gotcha ones. What the hell is this? .jpg. Hey, porn.
There becomes like a dividing line also, like especially Gachi Muchi, because I think everyone at this point knows, like, that's my favorite source. Like,
yeah.
Because I have assets that I use for my own videos, like, I've got a strange amount of porn on my computer because it's contextually in my head, it's not porn. But, like, in its original context, it absolutely is.
I feel that. A lot of people are like, it's like, man, you must have a lot of porn in your hard drive. And, like, I guess. Like, I have a lot of McDonald's on my hard drive. Does that mean I really like McDonald's?
Right. Like, you know, I waste so much time, like, cycling through extra, like, which blue bag, you know, which green screen am I going to grab today? It's a pain in the ass sometimes, you know, just especially when, the naming conventions weren't put in properly. But I think that's an organization issue more than anything else. So, yeah. You found it?
No, I remembered something else. I remember I used to edit audio clips and make them loop for fun.
Uh-huh.
Way before all that, too. Which is really interesting. Oh, man, this is going to be my first video. Is it this one?
The mystery.
Oh, God, it hurts my ears.
Oh, no. You look back on your failures.
Oh, I have so many old videos that no one remembers existed. I have, like... this one, what's the age of this one? Let's go. It's okay, definitely been doing this over 10 years. It was Star Maze with Gabe Newell, and the date modified on it is August 10th, 2010.
Okay.
What else do we have? A puzzle bobble theme. I'm gonna send this to you later.
Oh, I look forward to it.
So
it's another puzzle bobble theme.
Yes, it actually starts with Gachi too. It's way, way worse, and it switches sources three times.
Excellent.
It's Gachi, a source that I'm not going to talk about. Old Spice. What's this end with? Just Old Spice. I don't know. There's a lot. And then the NFL theme one where it's Terry Crews completely off pitch to the NFL theme because I don't know.
Well, like the Monday Night Football, like, da, da,
yes,
da, da.
It's the Fox one that they play.
Excellent.
Well, I guess all these are off pitch. I love this.
Yeah, this is another good time to go off of one of my other questions I had for you. You've worked with a lot of sources. Like, what is or what are your favorites, and how did they become your favorites? And, like, I should say, not specifically like this one clip, but like as a whole, like a subculture. You know, Ronald McDonald or Gachi or Old Spice or whatever.
I mean, the easy and obvious answer to that is Gachi. It will always be Gachi. I still play around with Gachi a lot. I have a lot of Gachi sitting on, you know, my hard drive that I'm still working on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm always like Gachi because it's rough. It's like like punk rock.
I was going to say punk rock. That's exactly
grungy,
what I was thinking.
Right? You know, it's low quality, shitty microphones and like grunting and you know, you got this mean, angry percussion. And you know, yeah. I'm big into punk, amongst a whole bunch of other genres. You know, the faster the music, the better for me. And I, you know, I always grew up listening to punk with my dad and going to shows. You know, I ruptured an eardrum jumping off a stage.
Oh, man.
I have stories, dude. Like, a lot of people are like, oh, yeah, you know, you're just this quiet dude. It's like, no.
When the mask is on.
Literal scars.
I'm quiet when the mask is on.
Yeah. I don't know. My brain is, I always tell people, it's like, man, everyone's like, you're so chill. And I'm like, not in my head.
Yeah. Well, it's like Phoenix, right? You know, you ever play those games?
I played a little bit of the first one.
All right, so, like, during the games, you get to see him just kind of having total meltdowns at times, but then, like, in the fourth game, he's not the player character, and he comes off cool as a cucumber and like a genius, and then it's like, no, he's, you know, that's just because you don't see what's happening inside. You know, there's so much going on.
Yeah.
It's like that. So, yeah, gotchi for sure, huh? I mean,
definitely.
For me as well. I had seen so many things because I really was late to the game relative. I mean, now it's been a number of years, but, like, when I found gotchi, it put itself on a new pedestal over everything else that I had already seen, and I already had liked otoMADs and stuff. Like, it's really, yeah. There's something special about it.
Yeah, there was a weird mix for me when I started, because I started with gotchi and then, like, Ronald McDonald are the ones, like, I saw first. And then I started messing with the Old Spice commercials at the same time. I'm going through these old videos right now I have on an old backup of an old desktop. It's funny because my first 10 videos are completely off pitch. like, horribly. Like I don't... I understand, like, as me starting...
Right.
Like, that's fine, but I feel like people would be like, you're kidding me. And I'm like, no, that's kind of how you start.
You start somewhere.
But, like, Old Spice is in that regard to where it comes... Like I said, I was going through these, and I have a lot of videos that I switch sources. And if you ever notice, I never mix sources because I don't like to mix sources.
Right, you keep a video consistent.
But a lot of my first stuff, it switches three times. You know, I see Shuzo in this video and Terry Crews, and then there's some gotchi in there and a couple other sources here and there. The big squeaky turkey is in this one as well. But the like those are like my... It's weird because I've never done anything with Ronald McDonald. Or finished anything with Ronald McDonald. I don't know why.
Formally released.
Despite it being like number one or number two of what I've ever seen in terms of
your origin story.
Yeah, and then like I guess Terry Crews is somewhere between one, two, and three. Like one, two, and three of like the first exposure. Going back to the earlier conversation is like gotchi Ronald
and Old Spice.
Terry Crews, I think, or quote unquote bonk songs. If you remember bonk. That, which is which is basically the. ytpmv slash
it's a good era.
MIDI replaces.
There's still good content coming for TF2 anyway. Yeah, I just occasionally see something nice pop around. You know, I can see like Ronald McDonald. If there's any source reacting to you saying what you like, how it's one of the first, but you never made it. It's Ronald like with his hands on his head, spinning around a little bit, like he's dizzy.
Yeah.
Like how could you do this to me?
Yeah, basically the end of the Pepsi Man video.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, Pepsi Man was definitely... You've had, like, a number of standout, like, boom, this is, you know, phenomenal hit. And, you know, both on your channel and on the Freebooters. And then, like, you know, so which... I want to, I guess, which of the videos that you have had as a great success were the biggest surprise to you?
All of them.
I knew you were going to say that.
All of them. Every single time, like... Yeah, all of them. Some of them, I guess, weren't because I was testing the waters and then never again. Like, I'm not afraid to say it's like, and it's not on my channel anymore. It was me testing Gangnam Style and the Guile theme.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to see if I knew what I was talking about when it comes to do viral things, and then it hit a million. I'm like, wait, well, never doing that again.
And you, like, you it worked, took it down right? But it was just there to prove a point.
More or less, yeah.
Mm.
I was like up to myself, right? I was like, do I know what people want?
Yeah.
Yes. Or do I know how to make viral content?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. That's cool. Fucking get out of here. that's a big struggle, man. That's a big struggle for me.
What? The balance.
Oh yeah. I don't want to be a bastard, you know, cause virality is money. It's,
right.
It's, you know, and I don't want, and I still don't, it's, you know, I haven't made a video in God knows how long. I want to make what I want to make, but I ask myself, am I stupid for not taking advantage of this platform that so many other bastards, you know, do?
Right.
Like, you know, YouTubers are the devil, and the second they see the possibility of making money, you know, they're like sharks in water. They're just like, oh shit, you know, like, oh, COVID is here, like, let's go, like, oh, I'm gonna make videos about it, you know, like. Horrible people, man.
Really? Yeah, it's just opportunist, you know.
Yeah, people have no morals, you know. People have zero morals, you know. It's like I'll never sell a gotchi shirt,
right?
Because the second I saw that Van was selling a shirt, I've never pulled out my credit card and copped something so fast in my life. Like, I've seen them on Amazon JP and shit, like, in the past, right? Before all the t-shirt websites had listings on them. And I was like, man, I want that. And I'm like, that's not anywhere even near official. And it's like, it's not sanctioned and it's someone else's image. But then he's like, oh, I have the van shirt. Boom. Like, I was just like,
right. I mean, it's 5 him, minutes. You know, it is him.
Yeah, it's his shirt. Yeah, I mean, it's him. It's his. He made it. It's, like, official Gachi from the official Gachi source.
Yeah.
Like, take my fucking money, man.
Right. Yeah. Yes. There's definitely a dividing line of, like, what's acceptable. Yeah. And that's something I can't stand seeing. It's like, so many people will take images and re-upload and make shirts of them and sell somebody else's content. And it just blows my mind.
I mean, go to Redbubble and type Ricardo in if you want to throw up, you know. I made a Ricardo shirt, for instance, for myself. And I've had, like, 20 people, like, please sell this. I go, no, go to hell. Like, I'm not going to sell this because this is a dude. Like, that's fucked up. I made it for me. But I have a good story with that shirt. Yeah, I gave it away at a con.
Oh, word?
I got drunk as fuck at the Faku party. And I don't know if you know Illusion, the hentai game, the 3D ones.
No.
I'm sure some people. So he was there, or one of their top-tier modelers was there, and was drunk as fuck, and he had a big Illusion shirt. And we're talking, like, they've been doing hentai games for 20 years, like, 3D ones, guys. I think they I have to look.
And so what became of your shirt?
Oh, I gave it to him, and I traded it for his Illusion shirt.
Nice.
So the only ever
Ricardo shirt you've ever made, or even Gachi shirt, you gave it to a friend, basically.
Yeah. Oh, they're the ones that did Honey Select and VR Kanojo. Okay. And Honey Select 2, etc. Trying to think. I'm looking through this thing of Sexy catalog. Beach Zero. Yeah. I'm like, So that was really cool, because I'm like, oh, these people who've been making hentai games since, according to this, 1997. Older than some of my people who watch my
contemporaries,
videos.
Contemporaries,
yeah. So yeah, the only Gachi shirt. Well, no, that's not the only. I also have a giant Akasan.
Oh, beautiful.
Just face is for me.
Dude, it was the weirdest moment to find him.
Oh yeah.
You know, it's really strange because, you know, for IWF they found him and he was in the
sauna. Yeah.
But by complete coincidence, I didn't know that he lived in Florida. I met somebody at a convention who's like, hey, I go to school with that guy. He's a friend of mine. And so, like, I was hosting a Gachi panel at Holiday Matsuri, and we called him on the phone.
Dude, rad. Yeah. It's a small world with stuff like that, man. Like, oh, my God. I can't even put into words, like, the things that happen at cons or, like, you're the friends with this guy, like, oh my God, like, I know him, or this and that. Like, it's unbelievable. Like,
human connections, man.
I don't want to, like, name drop or anything, but, like, I know, like, these people, and it's like, oh, his roommate's with this guy who's friends, you know, with this, and these people who, like, this person runs this company. It's like the Bill Gates, the fuck is the dude from Apple's name?
What, Tim Cook?
The dead dude.
Oh, yeah, Bill Gates. Steve Jobs.
Steve Jobs. They were like, weren't they like roommates? Like some shit like that?
I don't know.
And there's, so there's always, and I feel like that's always how stuff is, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
But there's somewhere they cross paths. Everyone knows. Oh, for instance, I became friends with someone, and this is semi-related, but I became friends with someone 2 years later after meeting Aniki next to them and didn't know them at all.
That's really cool.
And then
cool.
We realized while we were drunk in a thing, it was like, oh yeah, I met Aniki. He's like, oh, I did too. It was like, what? It was like at AX, and I'm like, what? And I pulled up the picture. He goes, that's me. And I'm like, but that's me right there. He's like, holy fuck.
That's amazing.
Like, you know, like both of us were already trashed. Yeah. And I was like, and now, you know, we're friends. And I was just like, where does this keep happening? And it happens like monthly. It's ridiculous.
No, absolutely. I found the first time I ever went to Anime Week in Atlanta, I had pictures from that. I hadn't really looked through them ever since then. And I went ahead and looked through. And the guy I was standing next to in line the entire time ended up becoming friends with me like 2 years later.
Yeah. You know?
And then I had no idea. And I was like, dude, look, this is you. This is you. The whole time we were sitting next to each other for like 30 minutes, you know, before even talked.
When I used to go to Magfest, we used to buy nuggets in
I remember thousands. You told me about the nuggets.
And I shit you not, I think it was this year or the year before, I was at a completely different con in a completely different state in a completely different time. I think it was Sanjapan either the year before or this year's September. And some guy walks up to me, he's like, hey, and it's like, I know you, right? And I'm expecting like, MowtenDoo, because I'm wearing the mask, depending on what mask I'm wearing is if I want people to recognize me. And he goes, oh yeah, dude, I remember you from MAGFest. Like, dude, you saved my life with those fucking nuggets at like 1 in the morning. And I was like, what? And this is at like 3 in the morning in a rave, right? Like he taps me on the shoulder, and I'm just like, are you fucking kidding
You're
me?
my hero.
Yeah, but there's a completely different in a completely different state.
Yeah.
Like, and that's why I like wearing the mask, right? Because you're not gonna I have trouble identifying people's faces, but I'll remember the guy with the stupid mask and the
Right,
hat.
right, right.
And so that to me was hilarious, and I'll never forget that because I was like, oh, look, it's a fan or like someone that recognized like, oh, I know you. I had people like, I know you from Twitter. I'm like, what? Like Twitter, really? Like of all
Yeah.
the places? But I was like, it's like, oh yeah, thank you for the nuggets. I'm like, are you kidding me? Like,
That's
oh my
hilarious,
God,
dude.
it's so crazy.
So I mean, and you bounce around cons a lot, but I mean, you yourself have kind of maneuvered in and around a lot of these creative communities. Among them, you were working with the Japanese on collaboration. So I did want to ask you about that. How did that come about? How did you go from being this Westerner to actually getting involved in the Japanese productions?
I like this story. Maker actually found the post of this. I followed a few of them on Twitter, right? And I had a kind of an idea when stuff was going on. And I don't know if you know Kunai, but he is definitely one of my biggest inspirations forever and still is. He's still active. I forget his whole shtick of a name on Nico video. It's like something something 3 blocks down from the JR station. Legend. But I saw he messaged a different gotchi creator and I was like, hey, I need to talk to you in DMs about something, right? And I'm like, So I hit him up and I was like, are you guys talking about the end of the year thing? I want in on that, like half joking. And he DMs me. He said, hey, you want in? I'm like, what? And context to this, me starting otoMAD, my dream, legit dream, was to work on these videos. And I want to say that they were the reason I started video editing. It was fun making stupid shit posts, and then the end of the year popped up and the collabs popped up, and I saw that the ceiling and the bar was way higher than what I expected. Right? It was like, oh, these are fun, haha. Like before, when I first started, like the thing you want to do is be able to make the pitch match. Like, damn, that's some shit. And then like, oh, the visuals are pretty cool. And then that comes out. And you're like, what?
You see the top of the
What the?
mountain.
Yeah. And so I started, and I think that's why I started going up in visual, right? Like fidelity, because I'm like,
You wanted to chase it.
yeah, this is the most amazing thing I've ever seen. Like, remember how I said earlier, this is the craziest thing I've ever seen. I need this, right? And then I was like, this is the greatest thing I've ever seen. I need to get to this. And to me, the irony of it was what everyone now I feel associates with me, which is you're putting way too much fucking quality into a shit post. And that was what I saw, and that's what I adored. It was the joke. That was the entire joke to me. Because gotchi stopped being a joke after a while. To most of us, gotchi is not a joke
It's not
anymore.
a joke, absolutely not.
Right? It started as a joke. Ha ha fun. Like not the everyone says ha ha funny gay porn, but it's like, oh my God, like they're remixing gay porn, like this is hilarious. And then it
It's
changes.
an
It
art
changes
form,
over
but
time.
it's also like it is a philosophy.
It becomes more than that, right? And I'm glad I'm having this conversation because I don't talk to people about this conversation. Where
They don't get it.
you it becomes almost propaganda, if that makes sense, right? Because it's just like you're portraying these people as awesome and
These
cool and like
personifications.
godly. Yeah, that's like the big muscle man, and he's strong, and and he's being remixed into like Bayonetta or something, and so you see it, and it you have this like, I don't know if it's like a complex, but you're just like, this is cool as fuck. And then it stops being the weird gay porn because you've now disconnected the homosexuality from the
It's
videos.
become actual iconography.
It's yeah, exactly. It's become like Roman and Greek, sculpturesque in some ways.
Absolutely.
And so and then becomes like cool and manly, and you know, you, and then the music starts fucking going awesome, you know, because like, people are mixing the audio super well, and it's just like, yeah, you know, this, you know, and you hear a lot of people say it's like, oh, this sounds better than the original track, you know, kind of thing.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I did a podcast, was it 2-3 years ago with Critical. And it was really interesting explaining Gotchi to them because they didn't know anything about Gotchi. And I had a lot of people message me afterwards, and they're like, I understand now, like, what you mean
about
it. You
had to educate.
Like, yeah. Or it's like when Anarchy passed away, you know, I had a lot of people that are like, I typed the thing up, you know, 2 weeks later. And, you know, I was like, this person had the biggest effect on my entire life. And people were like, he was just a meme. And I'm like, it was not just a fucking meme.
Yeah.
You know, it became so much more.
For him, too.
Just in general, right? Because most of the people, all the IWF people, you're video editing now. You're doing motion graphics. You know, they learn 3D so that they can continue to make cooler and cooler and cooler shit to climb the top of that mountain. It's not a meme anymore. It's
a legitimate, you know, rite of passage.
Yeah, or like it's an inspiration to grow.
To be more. You got me, Nana.
And that's where it started for me, right? So I saw those, and I was like, I want to do this. So like I said, I hit up Kanai. You want to do it? I'm like, shit, yeah. And this is after the 1 year got canceled. So I think it was 2013.
Mm-hmm.
No, or 15. Where they didn't have one that year, but they decided to move it. I think it's because one of the main guy had to move.
Okay, and it just kind of like threw off production.
Yeah, like I think he was moving. Like, correct me if I'm wrong, anyone in the comments. It's been so many years and so many things. But so I went in and, you know, and I did the summer one, and that happened, and then they invited me back. And I did the New Year's one, and I'm trying to remember if that was the only one I did that year, because this is when the collabs started getting absolutely ridiculous. Let me see. I actually have a list of all of the collab sheets somewhere, because I save everything.
Excellent. Yeah, it's really... I'm glad that you kind of hit on that, because there is such a misunderstanding for those who see it for the first time and don't understand that there's so much more depth and meaning to the process. And so many people I've heard this say, like, you take this too seriously. You know, you like, calm down. It's not that serious. And like, they don't understand that there is a fundamental underlying importance to it. And also that, like, to see quality like deteriorate over time is a sign of like a weakened culture around it,
you know? Yeah, it's really interesting, because I do feel like it is taken too seriously, and I think this is something we can segue into.
Yeah,
it needs to be like, take it as serious as you want, but this, I feel like this is the decline of collaborations. I'm trying to think.
Why is that?
Because it stops being fun.
Mm-hmm.
And this is where, I wanted to touch on this. You know, this is where I stopped doing collaborations, or, you know, I would hurt myself.
Right.
I would hurt myself really bad
in the process of making.
Yeah. Multiple times, you know, a few of the collabs before the one that I did, I was balancing finals while doing them. In a production school.
Yeah.
So I had like 6 finals, and then I had a week between that and the video. And then the video would come out, and then I would start school like 2 days later.
Right.
But like, I think a lot of it has been damaged by wanting, I think it's caring too much in the way that you're going to hurt yourself.
Mm-hmm.
If that makes sense. Like, there's nothing wrong with that, but it was something that has like hurt me in a lot of videos overall, is that I want to beat myself, and then I want it to be the best. And I feel like a lot of people in collabs want to beat the other people. They want to silently I mean, because art is always competitive. It doesn't matter. No, that's just what it is. It doesn't. You will not tell me otherwise unless you're all working on a single solitary thing. So not a collab with 10 parts. It's all working on one part.
Right.
Because that's blended together. But art is always competitive. In college, for me, it was very competitive. You wanted the best final in the class.
Right.
It's just human nature.
It's the nature of the beast.
And I feel like collabs were that way, where you not only want to beat yourself or what was seen before, you want to beat everyone else subconsciously. You know, I think people watching will disagree with me, but this is something that, you know, I fought with for a long time. And so I would damage myself. I would damage myself significantly. You know, I would have breakdowns mid-project. You know, I mean, we all talk about crunch. We've heard about production crunch and this and that, right? But, like, I would do that to myself to extreme degrees. You know, and because I'm such a perfectionist on videos and this and that, you know, there'd be the 12, 13-hour days for a week on a collab. I mean, there was a time where, I think it was 2017, I did both the Eastern and Western collab at the same time. Because I'm stupid. you know, because I like to punish myself. And I think I was in school when I did that too, because fuck me. And you know, I've done my fair share of hurting myself. You know, I have a lot of people, you know, don't realize for you know, the final IWF I did, which was Dream Come True. I permanently, like, scarred myself on that. And I don't think I've, like, worked the same since.
Right.
Because I was like, my sleep progressively got less and less the closer to deadline. So right. It was like normal sleep, 7 hours, 7 hours, 6, 6, 5, 5, 4, 4, 4, 3. To the point where I'm, like, shaking, right. You know, and, like, sweating and stuff, you know, and then that whole thing was just really, really.
It was a very dramatic time. I mean, all around the board, you know, and also the hostility in the air around it.
Yeah, I mean, and that's the thing where I go back to, I think everyone cares a little bit too much, you know, including myself, right? But if it was supposed to be a fun project where everyone's having fun, then everyone will pat you on the back and be like, it's fine, everything is good, right?
Right.
Like, you know, life happens or this and this, you know, but not the bloodthirsty, you know, rip you apart.
Yeah.
That you see, you know, happens in a lot of these collaborations, you know. To be honest, and I don't think a lot of people know this, is that was going to be my last collaboration no matter what. That wasn't the reason I stopped doing collaborations. I came into that, and you could ask Moy this, that was going to be my last one. And that probably also contributed to it
the pressure
being the most dangerous for me. Yeah. Because I knew that this is my last one, because I can't do this to myself anymore. Right. And this is before I even started, because, you know, I can't take a month off of even doing videos for my own channel.
Right. To work on the high production quality needed for a collab.
Yeah. I mean, it's not like I don't need to make things to get some sort of reward, but it's kind of like, you know, you finish it and you sleep for 3 days and then you wake up and you're like, why did I do that?
Yeah. What was the point?
Like that, like I don't expect anything from it, but like I shouldn't do that to myself in that regard, you know?
Right, for something that's not even like it's not even putting like food on your table. It's just something you're doing purely out of passion.
Oh yeah, you know? I mean, and that's the fun of it, and like the passion. But like when you take passion too far, it suffers.
Yeah,
and
it becomes damaging for sure.
For everyone, right?
Yeah.
I'm not the only.
No,
I'm
absolutely not
the only
not.
Person.
You're not
on those. And this is for all the people who are watching this who aren't a part of those teams. Very many people do not do them anymore, and very many people are damaged because of it.
There's just a persisting psychological like anxiety around it for a lot of these people, I would say.
Yeah, I mean, but it's because you love it and you
right.
care. You know, it's like you would die for your child, right? Or, you know, this and that, and you care. And it's tough because I can tell you care less. It's fucking hard, man.
Right.
You know, it's any one of my videos, I still torture myself, you know. But I feel like it will degrade quality from a video. You know, there's a big difference between the last Octagon collab and the last Gachi collab.
Yeah.
And you can feel the fun. You can feel the difference in fun.
Dude, I loved Octagon. It was great.
It was good. You know, a really good example is play a AAA game and then play like an indie game that someone you can tell loved.
Yeah.
When they were doing it.
That's why I say like it was great because it was so fun.
Yeah.
You know, I enjoyed myself.
You can tell. You can tell on a subconscious level that people are having fun doing something versus like they need to do it.
Right. It becomes robotic.
Yeah. And the game that did that was Little Big Planet.
Yeah.
For me, I played a little bit of that and I was like, wow, these people fucking love to make this game.
Very
like
soulful.
You could just tell everything. There's a lot to it. And then, you know, right next to it, you put Call of Duty, you know, like yeah. Modern Warfare 4, and you're just like, yeah, that's a game. That, yeah, and you know, right? And it's like, oh, the game had like its own thing, but you feel it like on this soul level where it's just like, you can feel the crunch and the pain and the sweatshop come right off of it. I don't know if I'm the only person who feels that way, but I feel projects, anything, games, anything. You can just be like, this is a labor of love, and this was not.
Have you watched Dorohedoro, the anime? It's on Netflix right now. And oh my God, I you know, it's 3D, which all for a lot of people is like a kind of like a no-no zone for anime. You know, but oh my God, there's so much, like, it's just oozing with soul and love. Like, I feel it every episode. There's something right, you know?
I mean, Kimono Friends is like that, right? Like, Kimono Friends
the people loved
shitty.
It, yeah. They loved it.
It was a piece of shit, but it was, like, you started to feel it. Like, you're like, ah, this sucks. And then you're like, episode two, and you're like, they didn't care that it sucked when they were making it, because they just wanted to make it. And then you feel that it wasn't a pain, like, thing, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and even if it is a labor of love, there's still the balance of your mental health,
right?
Versus, you know, this and that, because you know, fun, and I guess like what I'm trying to say is like, if you have fun on something, it's gonna end up better.
Yeah, for sure. Even if it's not technical perfection.
I don't even go for technical perfection anymore. I'm a 3D generalist. I have a degree in art as a 3D generalist. I'm a literal college graduate. My videos don't have 3D in them. Why? Right. Because they don't need 3D in them.
That's a wonderful platform to jump into the substance versus flash discussion regarding collaborations and otoMAD and everything. I think like that's one of the things I've talked with you about, but also I've talked with a lot of people about, and I bring this up in my reaction videos often when I feel like there's too much effort going into what special effects could be used and not into the actual theming of the part.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I see that a lot. That's a big problem with people who jump into 3D too fast, I've noticed.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have the fundamentals of motion graphics, so it just kind of cuts awkwardly. It's like cool 3D thing is kind of going around and like the motion is not clean and clear and concise. Like, the 3D is really nice looking, but it's not cutting and, like, transitioning well between itself, whereas, you know, you have a lot of the really nice, clean parts that are, like, eye candy, you know? You can apply that to 3D. There's a meta to motion graphics to make it look good, and it's leading the eye, where you're moving things around the screen, and you know that their eye is exactly at this point at a given time, and you start moving their eye around intentionally to the next part. It's a really good meta, and it's one of my favorite things to mess with, because then you're like, why is this so fun to watch? And it's because I'm controlling where your eye is by moving this thing to the left, and then it swipes by something else that swipes by that way that I want you to look at as well, because that's the lead. It's fun. I love motion graphics.
Yeah. It's really, I mean, for me, it's absolutely savory to get to watch each of these new projects.
Yeah.
I have a very, like, I wouldn't say a hard no on reaction videos, but I made an exception when I started with Gachi Muchi collabs because I knew that the people who made them would be watching my reaction. Like, that was the whole reason I did it. And, like, I could feel the care, and I cared. So, like, it wasn't just some nonsense for views. Like, I didn't think I would even care other than the creators, and that's all I wanted to see it. But, like...
It helps a lot, right?
Yeah.
Like, it's very fucking thankless.
For real. Like this is the one example of where they'd actually get credit where it's due.
That's the only example. You don't get credit. Like, there'll be like one or two people in the comments, and I guarantee you, I'm not the only motherfucker who does this, where you go into the comments of the collab you're in and you try and find the ones that are talking about your part. Trust me, I do it. You know, I haven't been in any collabs for a while, but that's what I did, where you hit like the latest comments, you're like, does anyone tag my part? And they'd say like it's really good. Like you're part of a large picture, and you know people aren't going to say it. It's like working on a movie, and you're a VFX supervisor for a certain part. You know, unless it's the holy shit moment of the movie, you know, you're not going to hear anything about it.
But with Bodybuilder from the Underground, like, you know, people gave a fuck. You know?
Yeah,
it's
thankless. You know, one of the first collabs I did. I kind of regret doing this. It was one of the Octagon collabs. I told people not to tell them what part they did. Nora will give me shit for this, and that's fine. Go to hell. I'm friends with him, by the way. Sorry. Hope he's listening. But the reason why I did that, because there was a time where I think the timestamps were listed in the comments at this time.
Yeah.
Back in those collabs, like back when they used to do that. I was the popular one in, and I didn't want all the comments to be about me.
Yeah.
So, you know, because I've seen it in other collabs where people are like, oh, Mountain Dew's part's so good. You know, I love his part.
It happens all the time.
But because it was me, right? Because everyone who watches it only knows me in that case. And this is the time where, like, if I like the video, for instance, it used to show likes on YouTube's front page, you know, remember that? Like, it doesn't do that anymore, probably because people. So I wanted to like the video so it would show people, right?
Yeah.
But I was the guy with the 30,000 or 50,000 at the time. I don't know the numbers anymore. And so it would flood all the people. And if they saw that this was my part, they would just talk about me.
Right.
And I didn't want people to do that during the Octagon, that one Octagon collab, because I didn't want to take away from them.
Right. They put in the effort, and you wanted it to be spread out proper.
And all the comments are about me, because I'm the guy who liked it, who they were following, because it shared to the feeds back in the day, right?
Right. I'm here
because that's fucked up.
Liked it. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Or like what part was his, you know? So I, at that time, and you know, maybe it was silly or maybe it was smart. I don't know. I don't really think about it, because I don't care about the credit or like the clout or like, oh, you're the best. You know, I fucking hate my videos, and I still do. I feel like everything that I have right now is a fluke.
Imposter
people
syndrome.
People love, you know, yeah, like, but I don't feel like it's not bad imposter syndrome. Like, I it's, oh, you like my videos? That's cool, I guess. You know, I don't, but I like making them, and you know, maybe I like them for me. Like, I think they're cool to me, but I don't think anyone should like them, because I still think they're bad. But like, oh, that was hilarious.
Yeah, like,
I don't have a god complex about shit I make. You know, I think a lot of people think I do, and maybe I did in the past. But you know, we all grow up. But like, yeah, like I don't care about my size or my clout or like, oh, my YouTube channel is this big, or like, you know, I'm not gonna sit here and jerk off about it. It doesn't do anything for me. You know, I always have people like, oh, you know, you're so down to earth and this and that. So yeah, because I'm a normal fucking idiot like you. Like I do the same things you do on a daily basis. The only difference is that more people notice me.
Right. That's how all humans are, man. And I think there's like a horrible disconnect with reality of like, you know, people put people on pedestals.
Yeah.
It's like we all bleed the same blood, and we're all gonna, you know, wake up and go to bed the same way. Like, it's not.
And it goes the same for the Gachi collabs too, right? Because now you're working on that project with the fucking pedestal to it.
Yeah.
You have that pressure. And that's where it also goes into like, okay, you have the love, but now you have the pressure. You can't have the shittiest part, and you can't let everyone else down. And now you're hurting yourself even more. You can't have the bad part, and you can't be late, you know. And so you're hurting yourself here, because now you have that pressure. You know, oh shit, am I gonna make it? Oh shit, like is this gonna be worse than everyone else's, or is it like it's not gonna be up to the quality, or is it gonna be the bad part of the collab? Because you know, every collab kind of has a bad part.
Right. There are certain things.
The
quote unquote
bad part. Yeah. You know, like, but it's like, is it, you know, is it not working out, or like, you know, is it gonna transition well? And you know, so you have the extra.
Yeah, those things will definitely pressure. Be on your mind.
And it fucks with you, right? I mean, even now, I have a lot of followers, and I feel like all my videos need to be the best video ever made.
Right.
Just because I don't want to disappoint, you know? I don't want to disappoint people at all. You know, we had we you asked earlier about, you know, what videos did you not expect to go well, or, you know, to do what they did, and it's almost all of them. I thought people were going to hate Blend W, for instance, because it wasn't, in my opinion, as technically impressive as, you know, Weed Louise.
Mm-hmm.
And I was fucking wrong. I was very, very, very wrong. And that actually was an epiphany to me, because I realized that people don't want the technically impressive video, but they want the fun video.
Right. They want to enjoy it.
And that video was fun. I had fun on that video. I wanted to, like, have fun. I wanted to make it good, but I wanted to enjoy it.
Right.
And,
mission accomplished. You know,
it makes me think about what I was potentially working on right now, and how, like, maybe I fell into that again.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's a good time to ask this as well. What is your process like? Like, how do you come up with your ideas for what you want to work on, and how do you kind of go about, you know, what's the step-by-step going through, like, a new Mountain Dew production?
I usually get inspired by someone. I guess that's not so much nowadays. I don't really consume very many otoMAD.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, kind of in the past, I would see a video and be like, wow, that's a damn good video. And then, like, you'd be inspired.
Right.
So I wouldn't take from the video, but I'd be like, damn, they made, you know, I guess just around Big Blue. They made Big Blue, like, really sound awesome in media. Like, I want to do that, and I'll download Big Blue.
Right.
And I won't reference theirs, because that's bullshit. I'm like, because then you end up accidentally stealing half their audio.
Right.
I'll remember some of it and be like, wow, that was cool. And then, you know, usually I have to think to myself, like, what would go good with this beforehand, right? Oh, Gotchi would be good with that.
Right.
And I'll play around with Gotchi. And then, you know, and then the project never gets finished. And it's the right. 30 other projects that I have sitting there. Probably at this point, it's like 90. But, you know, I'll play the hand. And if I start to enjoy it and it goes along far enough, I'll finish the video or the audio.
Right.
If I finish the audio, I need to have an idea for the video.
Right.
In the past, that was a lot easier than now. A big problem is that as skill level goes up,
production time goes up. Expectation. Yeah.
And so that's kind of where I started falling off that boat over time, right? Like, the video started getting wider and wider in when they were posted.
Right.
Because your eye gets better.
Right. Your production times get longer.
Exactly. And, you know, I know how things work and this and that, and it gets rough. And so, like, a lot of times, you know, even with audio, my audio takes way longer. My first bits of audio, a lot of my videos I did in a day. My first videos I did in a day. And then you got better, you got faster, and then you got better, and then you got slower.
Right. Fine-tuning.
Yeah, because I can make the first videos I made in under an hour now, and some of my first, like, videos I've done in my first 2 or 3 years in 2 or 3 hours, which maybe took me a week at the time, but
right.
Now I know all the nuances.
And because,
you know, like
of
I
those.
Mentioned earlier,
yeah, you have to take more time to really implement those nuances.
Yeah, I mean, it's like I mentioned earlier with leading the eye, for instance.
Yeah,
like,
right.
That's not something that you just kind of you put some keyframes and it works. You got to test it. You know, like, is it working?
Yeah, yeah.
Is it working? Is it going? Is it clear? You know, and you got the color grading, and, you know, you're doing this and that, and, you know, and maybe that didn't work out, and you just spent, you know, a little bit messing with it. You know, maybe it was 30 minutes, half an hour, you know, or, you know, an hour.
I think
scrap it.
I got a really good insight to your process and what sort of goes through your mind when we talked about Wrestle in Peace for the first time. You were just even just breaking down, like, what you thought and what mattered to you, and, like, how you felt about it from. And I think that was an example of you not thinking something sucked, but really having, like, pride in having done something right. That was definitely very insightful to your process. You know,
yeah,
you cared.
That video is good on the conversation we're having now, right? Because that didn't need the flashiness.
Not at all.
Right. And I didn't want it to have the flashiness, because that's bullshit.
Yeah.
It's not what it's there for.
It's a tribute.
Exactly. But that's where maybe that made, to some people, that made the video very powerful, was because all my thought process and all the editing was me putting it into where things need to go and how they need to stick together.
It was very pure.
Yeah, it wasn't me trying to make it look really, really good, because, you know, if I were to mix both of those things, then the amount of time it would have taken would be exponential. I mean, that video took me 5 days, maybe a week. While I'm sobbing
the entire time. Right, yeah, crying every 2 seconds.
Yeah, the first thing I did in the entire video was the ending. I saw that in my head very, very clear, and every time up until when I posted it, I cried when I saw that ending. I edited that from my heart and as deep as humanly possible from my heart. Like, I will never in my entire life portray my emotions in a video as deep as that video.
Yeah.
And there was a lot of thought putting into it. You know, I mentioned before, it's paced in such a way that's very, very intentional. It's not just here's a clip.
It's thematically matched.
It is thematic. You know, the first, if anyone who's watching wants to, you know, compare the first, I'm trying to recall the first scenes. Motorcycle. I don't show his face at all. The motorcycle, I don't show his face at all. You know, it's like, who's this video supposed to be about? I mean, you know, but like you need that reveal.
Yeah.
You know, and then it goes to all the locations, that all this happens, and this is off the top of my head, so excuse me if any of it's, you know, wrong. It's been a couple of years. And then it's the reveal. Here it is. This is who the video is about. You know, and it goes through, I'm trying to remember what else there is in it. You know, him smiling, and it matches the theme of the music. I actually semi-referenced, or at least in my head referenced, one of my favorite videos of all time that's edited the exact same way, which is, it's a Vimalava Dam or whatever it's called, the Coldplay song.
Oh, Viva La Vida?
Yeah. But it was the way I said it was the way they edited it into Japanese.
Gotcha.
I think it was Dan as Danjiri. I'm not sure. But if you watch that video, it's very, very similar.
A spanking selection. They have it in that, I believe.
They have it in that reference to the original.
Yeah.
That was the one where someone actually painted like art.
Yeah.
For it, like I had that as my background for like 6 years. So it's very similar to that, but I felt it was perfect. But that whole thing, yeah, it was very, everything was broken down in such a way. And then, you know, I think there's a breakdown in the audio, and it shows him when he was young. I mean, there's those clips when he was like 19, you know, and then him on like the Love Connection.
Yeah,
was one of them. And you know, then it's like and then it was him interacting with all the fans, all the hugs, him in the Nico Nico era. Like, it was like the pre-wrestling series, the wrestling series, and then the like the claim to fame, and he's like he's on the stage and all that. And a few people know this, not a lot of people, but the part where all the mads flash at the end, I asked mad makers who worked on Gotchi what their favorite Gotchi mads were. So all those mads were people's favorites.
Nice.
Who worked on Gotchi mads. Yeah, those weren't random videos. Some of them were my favorites. I asked a few people, give me your favorite. And this is after I had radio silence for like a week.
Right.
Like it wasn't like no one talked to me for a week. And then like I was just like, give me your favorite Gotchi mad.
Put him in the bag.
They would drop me. Yeah, they would drop me like three of them. You know, I asked a few people around, and they're like, all right, cool. And I went and I grabbed them. And I still have like all of that stuff. And when I grabbed them, put them in the end. Did some fun stuff to the. Did some subliminal stuff to that, which was fun.
Mm-hmm.
Very tiny ones. For instance, like at the end, I have the Aniki chant, you know, that's like low.
Mm-hmm.
One of my favorite little audio plays that is a really good trick is that the entire audio track on that is slightly lower than it's supposed to be. It's like 2 decibels. You know how the end leads up to the final hit?
Mm-hmm.
It goes from -2 to 0, so it gets louder.
Nice.
It's very, very loud, so it hits harder.
Yeah.
So it gets, because it's the drum roll, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So it hits harder because it's doing all the cuts and it's doing, and you know it's happening, and then it hits the last note, you know, and you see him, he smiles, and then he walks away.
Yeah,
it's like, I'll see you next time.
Yeah, goodbye.
Yeah.
I'm getting chills thinking about it, man. That was one of the hardest times, I think, for anyone who really cared, you know, who like saw it as not the funny meme guy. I think for those of us who were on the other side.
Yeah. Like you know, like to a lot of us, he was Anarchy. He was Big Brother.
Death of a friend, death of a family member, you know.
I mean, he started a lot of people's careers. He started mine. He's the reason why I'm where I am today. I started video editing and all that and went into 3D. Like I said, I dropped out of the first college, which was for game design. I fucked around and did otoMAD and decided that I still want to do 3D, but I want to do it broader, and I want to do it for visual effects, i.e. motion graphics, etc. And it's because of otoMAD. And, you know, I'm a college graduate because of otoMAD, because of Anarchy.
Yeah.
And so, you know, and I don't think a lot of people understood that was, you know, really, really difficult in a strange way that, you know, someone that, you know, you're not really cross paths with, like, they change your life.
Absolutely.
Significantly, right? Like, and it's still like you know, people who aren't, you know, and there's going to be people who are listening to this, you know, I'm sure I'll post it somewhere or on Twitter and all that, who, you know, have no idea about Gotchi, at least to the level, you know, that maybe they know Ricardo at most. But it's a lot, like I said, it's a lot deeper than that when it's the thing that, like, starts, it's catalyst. Where you start from.
It's your catalyst.
It's like the people who saw Star Wars for the first time, right? Mm. And they're like, I fucking love Star Wars. And it's like, I want to make movies like that.
Yeah.
I want to do VFX because seeing that TIE fighter blow up the Death Star, that was the coolest fucking thing I've ever seen in my life. That was the catalyst for them starting that, right?
That was your wow moment.
And that's what this was for a lot of people.
Yeah.
And so it's a lot, you know, and it's still a dumb meme and it's a stupid concept. But, you know, like I said, when you take it to a different level of thought and like love, and, you know, you portray these people as like the cool guy that, you know, he's in, you know, Mother 3 or, you know, whatever video game that we're referencing that you already love. Like, you know, I love Donkey Kong. Ah, he's in the Donkey Kong. Like, this is great. I'm laughing. I'm crying. You know, there's all these emotions. You know, this is cool as hell. You know, all the Japanese ones, they jump in emotion. Some are really cool. Some have feelings. Some are hilarious. Yeah. You're laughing. You have the one part that you're laughing your ass off, and the next one, it's like, it's the flower part of you know, the one, or the bayonetta part.
Of
I think it was 2010. Like, it's just like, holy shit. Like,
it's a true roller coaster.
Yeah. I mean, even, and the Octagon Club was like that too. You know, you had fucking Minoru's part with the big blue, and then, you know, it segues into something else.
That was really well. I loved it, like the pink blue in Mu. Like, it was just appropriate, you know?
Yeah, no, absolutely. Right. And it's just, and that goes back to the whole just have fun, right? Because if that part was taken too far, it wouldn't be fun anymore. It would just be like, oh, it's 100% big blue. Look at these cool graphics of them like flying around. You know, it's like people who make source filmmaker porn, but then they try and put a joke in there, and it's like, this is not funny. I'm trying to beat my meat. Like, can you fuck off with this?
Oh, man.
I need to see the scout with the long neck in the background going, bonk, bonk,
whoa,
bonk,
what's
like,
going on over there? You know?
Yeah. And it's just like, can we save this for later?
No.
It doesn't. Sometimes, you know, like 3D and humor does not mesh very well. Honest to God, it doesn't. At least unless you're Pixar. Like, you need a really high level of skill.
Yeah.
For that, you know, and it's hard.
That, it's like, or your actors need graphics. To be on their shit.
Exactly, and you're already at a disadvantage doing mad stuff because you don't have a choice of what you're getting. You have to work with it.
It's going to always be the same quote.
Yeah, and like, I mean, I say this a lot to a lot of people, too. I'm like, you got to realize that mad is harder than VFX in a lot of ways, you know? You're given, usually in VFX and stuff, you're given pretty decently clean enough stuff, and, you know, I'm working with 320 by 240 compressed gay porn footage that is at a bad angle.
With
how the fuck am I gonna make this look like Bayonetta?
Yeah.
Like how like there's some serious shit, man. Like, but you know, I was given like a clean plate once that was like 1080p on a green screen. And I'm like, what the fuck am I supposed to do with this? It's ready to go.
Yeah. Yeah, that's so funny, man. It's so true. It changes so much. Like but you know, the thing is, limitation breeds true creativity.
Yes. Yes, 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 it does.
Yeah. We could talk about that a lot. I mean, just even,
absolutely.
You know, like, let's just look at video games. Like, how much, when you can't put everything in, you only keep what's good, or you have to optimize.
NES era shit is great. The clouds in Mario are the same as the bush in Mario, just one is green.
Bingo.
The one up sound is the flag sound sped up. It's good. Yeah, like it's definitely like that. And you know, like a lot of people who went from YTPMV went to Siva Gunner, and half the people in Siva Gunner are making music. There's a reason for that.
Yeah.
Moy is a musician now who's been around actually longer than me. Moy was someone I looked up to actually at the start. It's like, fuck, I want to make music audio like this guy. He's so good.
Nice.
And I became friends with him, and I was just like, man.
But that's that's like a kind of a good thing to surround yourself with, to kind of engage with the community at large, because you're surrounded by like-minded people who have similar goals, you know, especially when they inspire you. Like, it really, it kind of begets your own growth to know them.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. I mean, you have people who kind of care about the same things you do.
Yeah.
So it helps a lot. It's tough for me lately because I don't have a lot of people to talk to about motion graphics.
Yeah.
At least to certain points. Like, there's a couple people, but, you know, we're all busy. We're all adults.
The circle's shrinking, man.
Oh, absolutely. And there's different levels of passion, and there's different skill sets, you know.
Yeah.
I do have a few people I talk to about motion graphics. I know, like, all of one person, if that, that I can talk to about 3D.
Right. Well, it's just an issue of disciplines, you know.
Yeah, and 3D is a different set of... It's not really in AutoMAD /YTPMV, like, at least...
Not at that level.
The 3D I do, right?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, like,
creating
a lot
like
of people are doing kit
stuff.
Bashings. Yeah, like, they do kit bashes, or they'll have the Aniki model already that's already been rigged by someone else.
Right.
They don't know how to texture.
The text
they don't know how
is
to
flying around, you know.
Yeah, it's the C4D, you know, because C4D is made for that, to make it easy and quick, right?
Yeah.
And that's fine. There's nothing wrong with it, but it's just, like, you know, most of the people who work in the 3D on all the gotchi stuff and all that, like... have them model, like, none of them know how to model, and some of them do, but to a very, very light point. I've been doing 3D for 8, 9 years. I don't really have many people to talk to about,
right,
like, high level 3D stuff. It sucks.
It's a lonely road, but you know, and I think that's also a thing, is that you've had the time. A lot of the people who come in now, they're young, because they're the only ones who have the time to pick it up.
You know,
you have to be young or very, very available. Borderlining neat to have the time to even get engaged with this stuff.
1,000%. Yeah, no, I mean, that's why the amount of videos I've done over the years have gotten less and less. You know, when I started college,
game over.
The fuck did I start college? 15? I'd say 14, 15, 2014, 2015. Like, the amount of videos I started making went down.
Yeah.
And then after I graduated college and I moved out, and had to pay my own bills.
Yeah.
Like,
changes a lot.
That's a lot less videos. You know, I have to freelance to pay rent and shit. I cannot rely on the gotcha that is YouTube.
Because no, for real. It's so inconsistent.
It's not even that, but you know, half the time
demonetized.
Yeah, and that sucks too, right? Because you know, what happened to that month of work I just did then?
Yeah.
Am I not going to eat now? Like, it sucks because that's a lot of time. And I like high quality shit, right? I can make a pants video in 10 minutes. I can make one a day for a month. That'll make me lots of money. That's cool. Yeah. You know, what's the big meme right now? Let's think. I don't know. Fuck.
Yeah. Right. Like, even think of it.
Oh, and I'll do a wide Ricardo.
Oh yeah, wide. Wide is
Yeah,
popular.
wide is one of them. Sorry for adding topical things.
No, yeah.
Person,
Now
sorry,
the
sorry for the person who's watching this 3 years from now.
Fucking great job, dude. Now
I
it's
know.
Ruined.
I've always tried not to do that in videos.
Yeah,
though.
Yeah. You want to keep everything like don't talk about how the weather is at this
yeah,
given time.
Never
yeah.
topical. Yeah, I never try and do anything topical in a video just whatsoever. Because then it's just like you watch it X amount of time later, and it's like
you feel the time.
That was a weird time.
Yeah. No, I mean, but here again, we're also like referencing old memes. So yeah, we're talking about the wide meme that was popular.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, like it's easy to make video like money when you have stuff like that. I
yeah.
guess, but like, where's the
soul?
That like I said, it goes back to the conversation we had earlier again, where it's, you know, am I a fool for
not selling out?
Yeah, because you know, if someone dropped $100,000 on my lap, I'd be making a lot of videos.
Right, you'd have the time.
Yeah, I would instantaneously probably turn off monetization on my channel, completely, and post as many horrible things on it as I want.
Right.
But you know, the extra like few dollars that I get currently is pretty nice.
You don't want to lose
you know,
it.
You and I touched on this before. You know, I have people who don't like that.
Yeah.
But. You know, I've gotten shit from a lot of people. And they're like, oh, how do you do this to memes? This and that. Like, because I need to fucking live.
Yeah.
And, like, I need to balance making them with my time. Because my time is valuable. I could be doing freelancing for this and that. And if... Like, Blend W is, like, the most major thing I did recently.
Yeah.
It's just not recent at all.
Right. It's dated now.
But... I took off like a month and a half for that. And most of the time, because of how YouTube works, it doesn't even add up still.
Yeah.
It ends up being less than minimum wage. And it's a month of time. It's a lot of work. And I like I said, I would do videos for free. Fuck
right.
Yeah, dude. Like, but.
You have to pay the bills.
Yeah. Like. I don't care about money. I mean, it's pretty fucking obvious.
It's,
I would like to hope by this
yeah.
time that I don't, because I have, you know, 450,000 subs. I can upload a 10-minute video of white noise and monetize it, and I would probably make $300. It sucks. It
yeah.
fucking sucks. YouTube sucks.
Well, you know, I think about... things, you know, people use Patreon now. Patreon's become like the standard. But when you really think about what it used to be like, you know, I think of a good old source to reference. You know, in case my name's not familiar to you, let me jog your memory. I mean, he had a fan club, all right? Steve Rambo had a fan club, and all these different places had fan clubs where people would just sign up to be members of their fan club.
Yeah.
You know, and that was like a totally different era. That was a pre-Patreon way of monetizing your identity.
Yeah.
And I honestly, like, how else are you supposed to do it? Like, how are you supposed to get by unless you have straight up commissions?
I mean, and that's where you get this weird, like, that's what I'm looking for. Not two-faced.
Disconnect?
Kind of like a disconnect where it's, if an artist is doing commissions of something, of a real ass, like traditional artist,
yeah.
Why is it suddenly okay then?
Right.
Where am I different on this spectrum of creation that I am doing wrong?
Right. Yeah, no, and it's unfair. Like, why is the traditional artist who's doing a commission somehow morally superior to you for monetizing your platform?
Exactly. I need to word this right, because if I don't, then it's going to sound like I'm a fucking asshole.
Yeah, they're going to jump you.
Yeah, it's because, I don't know, I feel like when you have a higher pedestal of like, it's easy, you want to knock on those people way harder.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
Right? So, like, if I fuck around a little bit, and it's like, oh, you monetized this or did this, like, it seems way worse than, like, the 3 or 4 gacha games that are on Steam.
Yeah, right.
Like
those are unacceptable.
Or the 300, yeah. Or like the 300 like shirts that are on Redbubble. Like, but I'm the bastard, right?
Right.
Like,
you're the villain.
I'm the bad person in this situation. And it's like, But I can be so much worse. Like,
yeah,
I could
you
be
could
so
be.
much worse.
Oh, yeah, you could just go full Machiavellian and just embrace it, you know, and make your money, and then use that money to make the, you know, you get to the top, right? Like, I read a book by Gene Simmons, and that was kind of, you play by their rules until you can change the rules yourself.
I mean, that's where a lot of people do it. I mean, yeah. You know, like PewDiePie did that.
Yeah.
He hit the top and he's like, okay, fuck it. I don't need to play by anyone's rules anymore because no one's going to fuck with me. I'm above everything else.
Yeah. But I mean, you've been,
I'll make and break things.
You've been attacked and beaten down by YouTube on multiple times. Just demonetizations out of nowhere.
I mean, it sucks. Cause like, and then the thing with that is like, it just, it makes it harder for me to want to make stuff too. Right. And you know, when you have, And that's one of the biggest contributing factors right now as to why I'm not making videos is, like, it's not even the demonetizations. It's also just the stress that comes from that. Because if it gets, if a video that I worked really hard on for a month and a half gets claimed by UMG, it's not that I'm not making the money. It's that UMG is making the money.
Right.
Off of that, right?
That's one of my favorite reasons to put, like, 18 plus on a video.
Yeah, which I do.
Yeah.
I have that specifically on Wrestle in Peace, which I didn't monetize, fucking hell no, because I instantaneously knew that it was going to be claimed for the song.
Right.
Which it was. And I uploaded it as 18 plus so that if they're going to make money on the song, it was going to be like 3 cents.
Right.
And when I say 3 cents, I actually mean that.
Literally 3 cents.
18 plus. And I think in the year Pepsi Man has made like 15 cents.
Yeah.
That's not even I'm not even kidding. Like, that's actual fact.
You know, I think like there's a kind of, there needs to be a wake up call for transparency. Like with people who do think like, you know, oh, well you make all these memes, so you must be rich. And it's like, dude, this is what I get. You know,
now, you know who the rich people are? Are the people who steal the memes?
Yeah, the freebooters.
Really,
literally, like, honestly, pirates.
Like, that's the actual truth.
The modern day pirate.
Oh, freebooters make more money than I do.
Yeah, and you do all the
by
work.
By leaps and bounds.
You know, can even if you do manage to copyright strike it, they still got paid for the time it was up.
Oh yeah, but it's building the communities on Facebook and Twitter because you will buy and sell advertising space on the tweets itself. Most of the accounts that do that make tremendous money on it.
I can't stand
the one. Oh, you want me to ruin your day?
I'll ruin it.
Let's go. I'm gonna ruin everyone's day who's listening to this. You know dog rates?
No.
The Twitter one?
No.
The we rate dogs where they're like, oh good boy 10 out of 10.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, you know the one where people submit pictures of their, they submit their own pictures of their dog in their DMs for them to write one tweet, and it has like 3 million things.
Yeah.
Right. Let's see if I can find it.
Ooh, this is going to be good.
here we go. I'm going to link it to you so that you can react to it
live. Here we go. Oh boy, all right everybody, thanks for tuning in. Here we are with the Stanpai with another reaction video. Today we're going to be taking a look at this article from Mountain Dew about,
it's not even an article, I'm linking you a tweet,
just his Twitter. Okay, this is Francisco. He came forward during our search for magical ears like hashtag Dumbo, claims he's only tripped over them once. 13 out of 10 can probably hear a caterpillar cough, hashtag ad. Okay.
Right.
Oh,
it's,
man.
It's the We Rate Dogs account, the one that he types this of the pictures that people, you know how much he got paid for this?
Was it because of using the hashtag Dumbo?
Yeah, it's a Disney ad. This was paid for by Disney.
And how much did
That's
he
why
get
it's
paid?
Hashtag ad. Oh, probably in the tens of thousands, if not more.
Oh, wow.
He has 8.7 million followers, wow. Dude. Like, and that's where that starts to happen. The funny meme account that has 1.3 million, you know, views, the people who want to advertise on it don't give a shit. Hey, I'll give you $2,000 if you tweet about this thing.
Yeah.
And most of those people, because they're freebooting and they don't give a fuck, they do it under the table. So they won't put hashtag ad.
Right, right.
You need to legally. You need to
you have to legally.
That.
You have to disclose. I mean, what's like Kim Kardashian or one of them got in trouble for not doing so.
Yeah.
You know, it's a huge law.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh man.
We see that a lot.
Communication law is like the best, dude. It's so interesting.
Oh yeah. The how is it the? Oh, I forget the name of the not the CDC. That's the Center of Disease Control.
The FTC.
FTC. Yes. Thank you. Yeah, that's the FTC law. But yeah, like all this person has done was write a stupid sentence about someone's dog. Every picture that's in there, we rate dogs, is
a paid ad.
Was sent to them by someone, right?
Right, right. They're taking and someone's dog for an ad.
Well, not just an ad, but like,
and content
for this
one,
in this case, yeah, it's content. They're building the. That's where freebooting is bad, right?
Yeah.
Because you're building a brand. And so now I have 5 million followers. Now, because I stole all this content, I am, on the second hand, making money from this large account. That it's Ebombs World. It's how Ebombs World became a thing. Ebombs World was all stolen content. They watermarked all the content. It became a website that people checked out because of all the stuff. They sold ads. They made money.
Right.
Same thing. Same thing on a social media platform level. It sucks.
Gotta love it. Yeah, man, you know, you brought up Ebombs World. That's old, man.
Oh, yeah.
This is one of the things I also wanted to ask you about. Just mm-hmm. the evolution of the internet.
Oh, God.
I mean, you know, it's hard to remember because it transitions in such a gradual way that very rarely is a change night and day. You know, like you're progressively seeing a website evolve over time and then you forget what it used to look like. But like, you know, I would love to hear your thoughts about the old internet and the current internet and just some of the stuff that sticks out to you when you think about those two things.
God.
What was your favorite site like 15 or 10 years ago? I mean, was it Nico Nico? Where were you?
15 years ago was way before Nico. For me.
Yeah.
Right. It's 4chan.
4chan, sure. Really?
Oh, yeah. I was 15 years ago.
Banned for underage. So
yeah. No, I'm just laughing because I'm like, yeah, I'm 30 years
yeah,
old.
Yeah, dude, it hits.
Anyone listening, by the way, yeah, I'm 30. Fuck. Fuck. I turned 31 in 14 days.
Oh, happy almost birthday.
Yeah. You know of all people, right? I shared the birthday with Aniki.
Mm.
Oh, yeah. God, him and I have the same birthday, July 14th. Yeah. Exactly 20 years apart. He was 1969, I was 1989.
You got me, Nana.
Yeah, that's also why that made that a little bit more personal.
Yeah,
well,
yeah.
Right? Old internet sucked. New internet sucks. Internet kind of always sucked. I'd like to say the internet got worse.
Mm-hmm.
It kind of got better. It was like, oh, old internet, like pre-Google kind of sucked.
Right. Everything was poorly optimized in that regard.
And then it kind of got better. You had like a golden age of internet.
Yeah, I would
kinda
say like, it was like on the cusp of 2010 was a really good
time. Yeah, maybe a
time.
Little bit. Yeah, maybe a little bit after that, like. Like when YouTube became a thing before YouTube got bad, was kind of like, I think, the best internet, you know, where YouTube was this money hungry, angry platform of like, it was before YouTube was bought by Google.
Yeah, I was going to say pre-Google.
Yeah. Where like everyone on YouTube just wanted to upload cool stuff for like frag videos and shit. Like it was, you couldn't really make money.
Yeah, they just wanted the clout, the social clout. If
and then the internet kind of got worse and worse, right? Like we're like peak, in my opinion, we're like peak the worst right now. And I don't think it's going to get better.
I don't either. I mean, if you just see, like, if you look at those charts that show the space, the bandwidth and sites on the internet and how much has changed where it used to look like, you know, the early game of a civilization map. And now it looks like
it's
just,
so bad.
You know, five major websites and then everything else is a couple of stragglers.
It's because the internet became possible for everyone to make money on.
Yeah.
And so money is the root of all evil. So people do all these horrible things, like we go back to the freebooting, but then all the companies are blind and stupid to smart solutions to the problem. So they'll implement horrible problems that just fucks with everyone, and just makes things worse. Or like content IDs specifically exist on YouTube so that YouTube doesn't get sued, right? And so that they can continue to make money because they're servicing the ads no matter what.
Yeah,
they're just serving it to UMG instead, right?
Right, and it goes to someone.
Yeah, so they win regardless. Yeah,
whoever gets it, they still get their cut.
And so, you know, it's just scamming people or being a piece of shit, and it's gotten worse and worse as money has kind of gone into it. And then, you know, now we're in the age of algorithms and AI.
Yeah, we're approaching heat and death of the platform.
Yeah, so everything is running on that Twitter, Facebook. So you're not getting an organic feed anymore. You're getting what?
Right, a curated feed. Want in to quotes. See.
Yeah, yeah, and there's no. YouTube, there's no fucking way to fuck with that. Twitter, I think Twitter is the only one that you have control over that for the time being.
Right, you can set to be just the newest content. I've done that with my Twitter.
I think if that's even the case, the best way to probably test that is if you use TweetDeck, because TweetDeck is for companies, and company wants to read a curated feed. That's bullshit.
Right. No, you can set on your personal Twitter, you can set it to show you the most recent, so that's...
Oh, no, I know, but, like, is it?
Oh, yeah, I know what you mean.
It's kind of like how the YouTube trending is really? Not... is that trending? Is that video from Ellen DeGeneres with 15,000 views trending worldwide right now? Really? That's trending.
Ancient alien scientists suggest it may be so.
Yeah, like is this trending really? Yeah, like that's not curated. Yeah,
oh man,
shrug. And then, of course, and they do all these systems that try and keep you on the website longer. I've talked about this on my Twitter a couple of times. Facebook, for instance, if you have a link to the original content or any content in the main post on Facebook, it is less likely to be pushed to people's feed because you're trying to push people off the platform.
Facebook, yeah,
this is why it's fucking worse. For freebooting, because now someone's going to steal my video, and instead of crediting me in the main post, it's going to be them replying to their same post saying, oh, this is the source of the video, is this YouTube video?
Yeah.
Like, the road to hell is paved with good intention.
Right. Or more likely just paid with financial incentive.
Yeah. I mean, and that's most things, right? People don't give a fuck until money is involved. Right. YouTube is the same way.
I mean, as long as so-and-so watching the content gets to see what they want to see, they don't really care about how it gets made. You know, most people don't ask how the food got on their plate.
Yeah, and I mean, like I said, it's fucked because, like, the company's only... Like, YouTube is only going to change all the bad stuff they do with monetization and all the monetization and the claiming and all that when it starts to affect their bottom line.
Right, either provoked by lawmakers or by actual, you know, earnings reports. You know, but I also... I have to ask this about YouTube and kind of give them the other side of things. It is the one of the only platforms on the internet where you can host your content for free no matter how long it is. And that's, you know, that's worth something in its own right. I mean, all these other websites charge you to have even just a set amount of space, let alone an account.
I agree fully. I mean, every website, they're offering you a service, but it's a give and take.
Yeah.
Because YouTube wouldn't exist without all the people on it. It would not, the biggest problem is that they can be as indiscriminate in killing channels in this as they want because it's an ant hill with 3 billion ants.
Right.
If I walk over and step on 300,000 of them, what does that mean? Nothing.
Right. There's still several.
The only way that anything is ever going to change on YouTube is if half the top 300 creators decide to boycott it.
Right. That would force them to change. I mean, Markiplier. Something happened to, like, a number of his subscribers on YouTube, like his paid whatevers, you know, members.
Yeah.
And it got resolved in days.
Absolutely.
You know, and the same thing happens to a lot of people at the same time. It just, he was the biggest channel it affected. So, you know, on one hand, he did, like, a rage video being like, this is unacceptable. Then they contacted him, gave him a personal contact number. And, you know, that's great, but he also brought up at the same time, yeah, this is great, but that also, like, says a lot about everybody else, because I'm in a position of, you know, authority.
100%. No, I mean, someone tweeted this earlier today, where it was just like, why is it that the only time YouTube is going to listen is when something bad happens? They, as of the time of recording this, you know, they demonetized Shane Dawson for allegations, and people were like, well, why did we have to talk out for them to do this when it's kind of been known that this is a thing?
Right, same with like the Paul brothers.
Or myself, I was demonetized. I couldn't have fought that without of making a giant shitstorm on Twitter.
Right,
And
and
then the second time they did it again, even though they weren't supposed to because they looked into it. And by the way, they said they looked into it and they're like, oh no, this is wrong. And then it happened again. And it's like, we've looked into this. And they're just like, no, you fucking didn't. Like, yeah, I can tell you didn't because
we've had
this has
this
been
conversation.
resolved. Yeah. But the only reason it got resolved is because I'm a lucky
You have a
motherfucker who,
platform.
yes, and I am in a position of some power enough that, you know, the poor bastards who are running the YouTube account had to fuck around and deal with 30,000
Yeah.
retweets and like 150,000 likes and like 3,000 people yelling at them.
All right, guys, I
I
think we should address
forced their
this one.
hand. Yeah, I forced their hand because no one else could fix it. I had people with numbers at YouTube and they're like, we can't do anything about this.
Right.
I had to force a hand, and you know, and I've had and people, a whole bunch of people DM me during that, after that, who had, what can I do? I still have people every now and then DM me like, I got demonetized. What can I do? I go, you fucking can't do anything.
Yeah, give up.
Like, I'm sorry. Like, I, you know, and I kind of earned it. You know, as I know that sounds fucked up, but you know,
Yeah, you worked your way
that
up.
didn't happen. That didn't happen overnight. You know, my channel is like 12, 13 years old at this point.
Yeah.
I didn't make my channel, you know, last year and got to where I'm at now.
Yeah, and
Many,
then
many
you've
years.
been, and you know, the thing is, like, you've been through the different eras in which different things were successful for different reasons. You know, there's no way that given the current climate, if you were doing, I mean, maybe if the fun part of it got caught on the same way. I mean, I think of someone like Ditzy as a good example of a more contemporary creator who managed to get success using the
Yeah.
same kind of content.
He has fun. He makes
Yeah.
what he wants to make, right? He makes what he wants to make, and I respect that. You know, a lot of people come off at him as like, "Why do you steal MowtenDoo? This is like, oh, shut the fuck up, shut the fuck up."
Yeah, and
He
it was successful.
likes what he likes what he wants. He likes my videos. I find it very humbling. I inspired you. Fuck yeah. You know, like, good. You know, I don't care
Yeah.
what he's making. It doesn't affect me. It does not affect me any way whatsoever. He's not taking anything from me. It does not bother me. Shut everyone who thinks that, shut the fuck up. Just shut your fucking mouth. Shut your fucking mouth. You. No, he has fun. He makes what he wants to make. And his main platform is Twitter, which is you can't really monetize. You
Yeah.
gotta be above a certain threshold to monetize. He makes what he wants. Let him make what he wants. He's having
Yeah.
fun.
I mean,
You know,
with.
I'm an old grumpy man now. I don't really have fun with shit posting anymore, so
Yeah.
like I kind of toned it down and I only just make dad jokes.
Yeah. I mean, but the thing is, it's like with the way it's structured now, the content that's successful and gets you more subscribers is different than it was even when he was first hitting it on YouTube with his original channel before he restarted. And when you've been making content for how long you've been doing so. I mean, we have old channels that are like millions of subscribers who get barely any viewership because the algorithm has changed
Yes.
everything and all their subs have aged out of their content.
Exactly that, and you know, there's so many factors to that, right? Because
Yeah.
if there's a long enough gap between your video postings,
They drop you.
that it's not just algorithm. It's like, you know, people don't notice, or like they don't see it on the feed, or they are on a different account, or they don't really browse YouTube as much as they used to, right? Maybe they became an adult and they work and they do this, so like, why am I going to watch YouTube 24/7? You know, otoMAD and ytpmv, it's made for kids, not
Right.
specifically, but you know, your 35-year-old fucking, you know, cousin ain't going to watch Gotchi probably
Probably
now
not.
nowadays now because Gotchi's been around for so long.
Right, we
Yeah,
aged into it, but
but at the start, no. Like,
Right. If
no.
you were 35 at the time, unless you were some guy in Japan sitting on Nico Nico with like with a purpose, you know, you
Yeah,
wouldn't be
very
doing that.
few, very few people. And got like, and going back, we're gonna be segueing a lot of back to the old conversation. There's a lot of old Nico video people who had that passion on the made collabs who are big now. KSK is one of them, you know. Another one of my senpais. He does stupidly high level Miku videos, and he works at a, I think he co-owns Composition Inc., if I recall, or he works at it with another person that I look up to. I mean, he's the one who did Rolling Girl,
or yeah,
Rolling
yeah, Boy, so you I know, thought.
On the stairs, and he did
proceeded
the Evans
building size, what, a flower, no?
No, that wasn't Flower. He didn't do Flower. That was someone else. And a few other ones like that of that era. Mm. Legend. A fucking legend.
Does projection mapping on the side of a building in Tokyo.
Yeah, yeah, that was cool. He did, he's working on virtual YouTubers now. He did
Model
for Akai, I think is her name. The virtual singer, YouTuber girl. She's kind of like it's almost like if Miku was a VTuber.
Okay.
It's like she's like a musician. She's a diva kind of.
Almost.
Very good model, though.
One might say an idol.
I mean, she is an idol. Yeah. She's a virtual YouTuber idol. But she started with Gotchi.
Yeah.
Or like he had skills, but like.
That's where he was raised in the locker room, you know?
Yeah, exactly. But yeah. I don't know. I forgot what we were talking about.
I do too. I'm not sure where the start was.
It was YouTube, I think.
Yeah,
YouTube
and just the freebooting and the monetization. And
you can't. Yeah, you can't start on YouTube anymore.
You know, I started my channel at the start of 2017, so we're 3.5 years now.
Not a good place.
Yeah, I've managed to reach 34,000 at the time of this recording, and I feel good about it. It took me, I think, 2 years to break that initial 1,000 barrier, and then I made the right video. No, I know when my channel took off. It's when Smash Bros. Ultimate released.
You see, the size of your channel is roughly the size of mine in growth, if I recall. So it's not that off. But you have to rely on, like, outer means a lot of the times, right? Like, how many people do you subscribe to, like...
Oh, man, yeah.
From the recommended bar. Like, you click on the next recommended video, like, how often are you gonna, like, can you even think of any time you've subbed to a channel from a recommended video? Because I can't.
I do it almost every day. And the reason really? I do so is because I consciously think this person's just like me.
Hmm.
So that's, I go in looking for new channels that are worth following because I want them to do the same with me when they find my channel. You know,
I feel that.
I want to be part of the solution. So that's been my philosophy. So yeah, I'm a bad example because I tend to be an outlier in that regard. But
it's totally fine.
Yeah, I legitimately make an effort to subscribe to channel. If they make one good video, and I'm like, damn, that was hilarious. If I don't see a good recommended one in the end card, but it was just that much of a banger, I'll just hit. I definitely go out of my way to click like. Even when I'm watching on my TV with like a Fire Stick. You know, I'll pause it, just move over with the stupid remote just to find the like button. Like,
just
on the
hit
next,
the like button.
You know, just to make sure. That's,
that's where it gets fucked, though, right? Because then we're the algorithm is still in place, and you got to watch out for this one on your feed, right? Because YouTube will silently rate channels on your subscriber feed based on how often you go to them. So it's actually very bad for channels like Super Gunner is a good example for this, where they have 15 videos a day. YouTube is way less likely to show you their videos on your subscriber feed because you don't actively engage with them.
Right. And so what
YouTube sucks.
I open the subscription tab at least once every week or 2 weeks to see who's uploaded and to see if I want to watch it. And like,
yeah, hopefully it doesn't at least.
Yeah, that's
some off completely.
It's not on your feed. You have to go, like, you have to really go out of your way is really what I'm getting at. Like, you have
to. Which is stupid. It's stupid as hell.
You know, I consciously look because I care about the content that people make, and I want to see it. Like, you know, I see, Hamburgaga put up another McDonald's video. Well, all right, there we go. I'm going to watch it because there it is. You know, but
I mean,
it pops up on my subscriptions tab when I look for it, you know.
And that's the big problem where we talk about how, like, money has fucked everything up because they want to keep you on the platform. And the way they're going to keep you on the platform is that they're going to show you the videos that you want to watch, and you're curating your own feed at this point because you're showing their personal algorithm the ones that you want to see from the people that you sub. Because if someone subscribes to 3,000 people, but, you know, you really like, you know, the guy who I don't know, he crushes things with the pneumatic press, for instance.
Yeah.
Like, that's what's always going to show up on, like, the Oh, the for open sure. feed. It's like the home feed, right?
Yeah, it's always the new AVGN first.
Yeah. And that's also weighed on likes and everyone else who does it, right? Because they're assuming that that's the most popular on the thing because they want you to stay on YouTube.
Right, as long as possible.
Because ad money. Because that's where they make money. And it goes back to the same way we were talking about with Facebook, where Facebook, for instance, they will actively hide content. I'm almost certain that YouTube will not show...
If you put the word Twitch in your description, it's over.
Yes.
I had a conversation about
fucking
this the
other day. Certain that's the case, and I'm certain that's the case also if you put Twitch in a community post. I'm 100% certain it's Twitch, and I think Twitter is another one.
Yeah, you got to find.
I'm like 100% certain that's the case. They say they don't do it. They don't mention it. I'm
not falling
dead
for
set.
That. You know what it is? We need to do like the Chinese do because they have because everything's so censored with like the you know the Great Firewall and they have like the the Tencent army and whatever. You need to create a secondary language that refers to things that everybody agrees upon. You know,
do Pig Latin.
Yeah, I mean there are ways like people censor the word with like a little asterisk and hope for the best. You know,
yeah,
Twitter with an asterisk.
That's a good idea, funny enough.
Yeah. You know, it's the only way I could think of, but then you can't drop a link. You know, it gets filtered. It'll get filtered, and I think we all know that. You know, it's just...
Yeah, your community posts on YouTube will not show to
Believe
as many
me,
people.
I know very well about that.
Yeah. Your best bet, potentially, is, like, throw it into a GIF, right?
Yeah.
People don't like to put an effort, right? Like, I ain't gonna type that shit. So it's already
a lost cause.
Yeah. It might do better. Like, and that's the thing. Like, when you're paying attention to social media, it's the same. People don't like to also move platforms because it's a pain in the ass.
Right.
You know, I can scroll through my Twitter feed and this is like, check out our website. I'm like, no, keep going. Like, it could be really interesting and awesome. You're like, you know,
but I'm lazy
here's the website.
Right now. Yeah.
Yeah. Like anything that links off site, like in the image, that's like, click here to go to this. I'm just like, scroll. Like, right. No, I'm good. Same with YouTube posts. I mean, yeah. And Twitter does that on purpose too, right? Like Twitter will... YouTube isn't embedded like it used to be, right?
Yeah.
You have to click once for the video to pop out slightly, and then it embeds. And that's intentional to make it a little bit harder.
Yeah.
So that you're less likely to not just watch the video, but like go into the video and then potentially go around the feed on YouTube
and end up
because
somewhere
it was
else.
The recommended. Yeah. Because if you leave the website, that's no money. There's no ad revenue being serviced there. You know, that's why Reddit has a video uploader so that you can steal people's videos. That's not the case, but I mean, that's what people do.
Yeah, right.
And get that Facebook karma. As well, you know?
Yeah.
And TikTok is, oh God, that's a whole nother fucking can of worms.
Man.
I heard something fucked up about TikTok where your first post on TikTok is likely to do better than all the other ones and be pushed to more feeds, so you get that tiny little taste of fame. You get that little taste of that drug so that you're more likely to continue to make TikTok.
Really?
So that's a fucked up thing I heard the other day. I was like, fuck, dude.
Damn.
Someone was breaking down like the way it works.
The TikTok algorithm. After,
yeah, and they were like, yeah, it's more likely to be pushed farther and get more likes. I mean, Facebook kind of does that. They'll over-report videos.
Yeah. Look at your views. It was 3 seconds. It's a view.
Yeah, or like, and they do that for ads too. They're bastards. Tech sucks. The internet's getting worse. It's going to continue to get worse, especially as we have AI try and dictate what they think we're going to like. And that's just going to change the meta of what we actually like, because I'm tired of being forced the same video. That's the red hot glowing knife for 3 hours because it thinks that everyone wants to see that video.
Yeah, I don't know, man. Metal Gear Solid 2, they were right. They've always been right, man. And now we like what they convince us everyone likes.
And then it gets just worse, right? Because then you have the bad actors, because the internet got so big that it's like, well, the unmoderated, uncurated feed is going to turn into link spam to
who knows what,
like adware, right? Yeah. And that's where you make the money, or you know, the I mean, it was like a couple of years ago, people were putting ads on AdSense that were mining crypto. Like the ads themselves, they were like running JavaScript or something that were working as a miner.
That's
or something.
Hilarious.
Some shit, but there's like the the internet became possible to make money, and that's where everything went to complete and utter hell, because there's no morals here. Like, you have no face, you can be a piece of shit.
Yeah,
and everyone on the internet believe is a piece in the of net. Shit.
Yeah, it's a shame, but anyway, that's human nature. That's how every system is. Every system exists in a way that people, they are intrinsically incentivized to look for ways to game the system for their own benefit.
Absolutely.
That's how life is, you know. Otherwise we die.
Like, oh yeah,
you have to. I mean, in your case, you're resisting it as much as you can, even though, you know, you can. And now, in my opinion, honestly, I don't think it would be so terrible for you to make like little shitposty fun videos and get some monetization out of it. But like, yeah, you know, that's you trading what you consider to be like your soul, essentially.
Well, the fun part about that is I still have to, I'm still creatively limited, right? Because if I use X song, that's the end of
it's over. Yeah, it's already
if the video is under 15 seconds, you can't run an ad. Like, I don't, like, it doesn't matter in that case. Or if I know, like, if the video pushes 10 minutes,
double,
you can run three ads.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can, or whatever.
Before it is, and
or
after.
Yeah, or if it was every 10 minutes now, you can run, like, an extra ad. So if you have a three-hour video, you're going to be rich off this one. I better get some money after this. No, I'm kidding.
Yeah, right. Everybody, make sure not to click skip ad on all the video ads on this particular conversation. We count on that here. Yeah.
The watch time up too, you know, if there wasn't enough things to fucking juggle on this piece of shit platform.
Right. Listen, listen when you go to bed, all right? Just put it on and let it play.
Keep it on repeat. Like, just like, I have a playlist here of my channel. Just hit make sure that the next is on autoplay and make sure it's the playlist of my channel so that my watch time goes up, you know, like, so cool, because, you know, if it drops under 50%, then my videos don't get pushed to the algorithm. So no one's going to see my channel because YouTube has determined that they suck. I wish I was kidding.
I know, right? You wish, like, you say it as a meme, but everything you just said is just a fact.
Yeah. YouTube is a hellhole. And of course, it brings out the worst in people, because now it's you know, and people say, don't hate the player, hate the game, but I'm going to hate you because you're a piece of shit for playing that way.
Yeah. I mean, it just kind of has to be, like, this established understanding. It's like, listen, I don't make the rules. I'm still going to do the content that I care about and that you care about, but I got to also pay the bills. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, hey, look, every AVGN starts with a Nord VPN ad. Or ExpressVPN, rather.
I mean, I'm friends with a lot of them. You gotta make your money. You gotta pay for your either cameras and the editors and
right. You know, there's no other way. Like, it's gotta be done, otherwise the channel would stop existing, because it's got a family.
Yeah, you know, if you want to make, like, big content, I mean, I know AVGN, he's got a wife and he's got a child. You know, and he's got to pay for his crew and his editor. You know, once you get past a certain point, you got to pay other people
to make your content. Yeah.
Yeah, like, I could make a lot more videos if I had a team. I try not to. I mean, I work with Moy a lot actually for that reason, right? But I pay Moy.
Right.
Spoilers. he's like, please don't. And I go, no, you shut up.
Yeah, you work.
Take this money. Take it. And they're like throwing at him. Like, I know your PayPal email, you bitch. You better.
You're not escaping.
Yeah, you're taking it. Why not? You know, because sometimes you need help, and sometimes you have a vision that you can't achieve, right?
Like, yeah, you need a team sometimes.
You know, if you're gonna make a movie, you need.
Yeah,
you need people to do shit, you know, like, I want these cool VFX where this guy's head explodes, but I'm the writer, like, I don't know how to do it. Or if, you know, if one guy can make a movie, it's possible.
It can be done.
It'll take him 30 years.
Yeah, it's a lot more effort.
So, it's one of those things, you know. But I also don't like when things get divided in writers and all that personally, like YouTubers, because then you kind of...
Well, you lose your identity, like, you know.
Yes.
If I'm here to watch you and your content's been written by someone else, like, am I even watching you anymore? You know.
No, in my opinion, no. I like to be the director.
Yeah.
And I'm still working on it. Like, anytime I've worked with Moy, for instance, I give him a skeleton and then we talk about it a lot. I mean, it's like, hey, I did this, or like, hey, maybe you should try in this, because he's just a lot quicker and he's a lot cleaner. You know?
Right, he's very good at what he does.
And I'll be like, don't do that, like, get rid of that, you know. And then, like, he'll give it to me, and then sometimes I'll play with it. I'll add stuff because he gave me some cool ideas, and take it back here, boom, like, play with this. It's like, hey, I need a little bit more here. I can't think of anything. Can you help me? Because you're better at this than I am. And, but she is, and he's a lot better than I am at audio. He always has been. I've never been able to catch up to Moy. From the time that I started until now, I've never been able to catch up to Moy. Which is really funny. Like I said at the start, I looked up to him, and I'm just like, he's so good. Like, I want to get as good as him. And like, I've never been able to catch up. He's always been like 1 to 2 steps ahead.
Right. But really, I mean, that's you know, his bread and butter is like, you know, we all have our specialties, the things that we excel at, and I think that's quite fine.
I wish I did.
Well, you know, the stuff that you do excel at, I mean, you just can't really use it most of the time.
Yeah, I just feel like I stretch myself super thin.
Master of none, as they say.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I always like to describe it like a digital media red mage. You know, that's how I've always looked at myself. But I realized, like, no, I can get by just on, like, voiceover. You know?
Yeah. I mean, it keeps the jobs open. I just, yeah. I hurt myself. Not hurt myself, like, I feel I'm saddened as an artist. Like, I have no problem making money. I'm just sad as an artist. Like, yeah. Most of the time I'll beat myself up because I'm just like, I know all these stuff, but I'm not good at anything. And I'll see, like, someone, like, post, like, a killer fucking 3D model. I'm just like,
why did I put my points in all the different trees instead of just one, you know?
Exactly, yeah, because, you know, it's just like, oh, I do audio, and I have music skills and this and that, right? But if all of it was in the one, I would be, like, the most god-tier one thing. You know, mm-hmm. I can 3D sculpt, I can 3D model, I know the entire 3D pipeline, I can animate, rig, texture, model, I can make music, kind of.
And that's what they call you, the freelancer.
Yeah, you know, and then all the other stuff, I know, like, I know so many programs, you know, Illustrator, Photoshop, After Effects, mm-hmm. I got motion graphics.
You know the suite.
I know basically that entire suite, Maya, ZBrush, Substance Painter.
If anyone's looking for a creator, he is available.
Yeah, please. too many programs, but I'm just like, man, I'd be a really, really top tier 3D artist if all I did was 3D. Excuse me. It's like specialists where like, oh, I can only model like the one guy. All he models is fucking trees or like bugs. I knew one of my instructors. He was known as he studied entomology.
Okay.
Or entomology, and he's like, all he modeled was bugs. But that's what he liked. Like, he used to model all this shit, but like, you want like the coolest fucking bug ever. He would, like, he modeled bugs like for museums.
And, that's
like,
awesome.
Like, yeah, like for exhibits in museums, right, showing off, because like,
it's the proper,
like,
portrayal, yeah, like, of the bug.
Exactly. Or like, you know, you go to a museum and it would talk about like this bug, and then you'd like look down at the screen and you'd be able to like scroll around
enhance
the model sort of, yeah, shit. Yeah, he was like that level. Because, you know, you can specialize on something and then you can specialize deeper and deeper, right? Like,
right, well, when you're the only guy doing the thing, then you always get the contract for that particular thing. It's simple.
Oh, absolutely. You know, it's like, oh, I'm an artist, but then you can specialize in art. Well, all I do is explosions.
Yeah,
like
I specifically do hands.
I think that's a little bit too much. I don't think I've ever seen that.
Well, no, it's absolutely true, because first person, like every first person video game.
Yeah, first person animations, yeah. I was talking about like drawing hands.
No. I was talking about just like modeling hands.
They draw like the rest of the body. Yeah. Like first person animations is a specialty.
Yeah.
And that sort of stuff. I don't know if so much the modeling the hands for first person is, just because if you can model a body, chances are you can model a hand.
Right. Well, it's more so the detail. And like, especially when you think of like different reload animations and stuff.
I know a few people who were special. That's their specialty, but they still have to do other things sometimes. Right. Just because, you know,
should have been a bug guy.
I mean, I guess, but I mean, it limits your jobs too, right?
Yeah, only when they're hiring bug guys.
Yeah, but you'll get paid out the ass.
Yeah, you could charge that rate.
Yeah, because you're the dude, you know.
You know, if you can consistently do something for, you know, even once or twice a year, but they pay off. It's like a farmer, you know. You harvest your crop how many times a year?
You just gotta hope, though, right? Because if you're not, it's, you know, like my roommate said, it's feast or famine. Like right now, I got dropped into like 3 freelance jobs at once after having a complete dry spell, and now I'm like, oh, I'm gonna die.
Right.
Like, why is it all at once?
Couldn't
like,
you guys
the
wait
the exact same time? Yeah, no, it always happens that way too. Like guaranteed, 100% of the time.
It's their budgets, man.
I've never had it like comfortable where it's like, okay, one job, this one is done. Oh, look, one just came. No, it's like, here's three. Fuck you.
No, fuck you, like, freelance
great.
Man.
I'm gonna. I have job and money. I'm going to be suffering now.
Damn, but it is what it is. You got to survive.
Yeah, I mean, and like, I wish I was making videos.
Yeah,
I want to make videos. And then at the same time, I sit there though, and I'm just like, I can have a bit more fun making videos, and then you know I can't pay rent.
Yeah, but and also for some people, I don't know if in your case, I mean, if it's all you end up doing because you like, let's say you pick up like a bunch of contract work, you know, when you finally are done, you don't really want to work on it. You want to just stop, you know, if you've been doing nothing but that one thing all day, when you're finally done, you don't necessarily want to switch to your project.
Oh, yeah, no, absolutely. And I mean, and that's just like the tip of the iceberg of like a problem with a project, right? Because there's a lot of thought. It's exhausting.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you can't get in the zone. I mean, interruptions happen and it's over.
Or just in general, like once you get to a certain point in making something, and I think a lot of people who are watching this like agree, it's not just, haha, I put it funny down, no thought. Like, that's the start, right? It's like when you play a fighting game, you know, you start mashing the buttons, haha, you do the punch, and then, you know, you start playing a little bit more. Someone made a really good example about fighting games the other day that actually is stuck with me, and it's when you start fighting games, you don't think at all, right? You're the noob. When you're mid tier, you think too much, and when you're top tier, you don't think at all.
Right, it becomes second nature.
Exactly, and it's like that, right?
Yeah. When your job is being creative, though, you can't take a back seat on the thought process.
No, but I mean, if you're that good as well, like you kind of. It hits, right? It's like, yeah. you just draw and it happens, you know. There's not a lot of thought. I'm definitely not like the high tier where I can just like psh, like there's sometimes I had one or two times where just magic
in the zone,
holy shit. Yeah, like it just, it's like, oh, like good example of that was Super Spice Bros 2. The whole second section of that video, I did in like a day in like one sitting.
It just went.
The other part was the part that most people thought was the most fun in Blend W, where I completely went away from the original video, where it's all chaotic in the middle. You can see it in the comparison video. I did that in one sitting as well, because I didn't like what was originally there. Like the speed of the audio, my audio actually became too fast when I was comparing, because a lot of the time I'll do the audio first, and if it's a parody like that, I'll play it over the original video and see how it feels, because, you know, if it feels cool, then that's cool. But a lot of the times you end up double timing it just because that's the nature of a MAD. It becomes double time. And I was watching it, and it's like, oh, fuck, that became too slow now. Like, it was fine in the original where there's just a complete break in the action and nothing is happening. But that's not going to work for this video because my audio is still doing this, but the original audio is doing this.
Right.
It doesn't work.
That creative groove, man.
Yeah, man, and I did that in one sitting, and people were like, this is cool. And I'm like, oh, sure.
Yeah, I did it. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, and that's most of the stuff I make, you know. It's just like, I did it. I kind of like it. Neat. Yeah. Like, I'm in a weird creative place right now with all that stuff.
Yeah.
It's tough. I mean, I'm definitely in an interesting rut when it comes to skill level, speed, and creativity, etc. And I think I'm discovering a new part of myself right now. You know, like where I want to go.
Right. What inspired that? What is the catalyst for this discovery?
I'm old.
Perspective that comes with it.
I think I'm finally kind of outgrowing my content. You know, there's been too many times where I think I've been embarrassed to talk about what I make,
right?
You know, where I'm doing not quite industry stuff. I mean, I've always been embarrassed, just because that's the way I am. Like, I if I showed you my 3D work, I would be a little bit embarrassed. Even at my graduation, when they were going through all like the everyone's portfolio, I was like cringing up, and I like almost drew blood on my girlfriend's hand.
Just squeezing.
I was like squeezing it so hard. Yeah.
Yeah.
Cause that's just the way I am. And I think I found for like too long, at least recently, that like I'm not proud of that stuff anymore. I enjoy it, and I like making people laugh, and I like doing stuff like that a lot, but I don't know if that's quite me anymore, right? Like, a lot of people have watched me grow up, you know. A lot of people are my age, which is really interesting. I have a lot of people that I've seen for, you know, 8 or 9 years in the background, that they've liked my tweets, or they've poked me, you know, or responded to a tweet, right? And it's like, you know, and then there's a lot of the new generation of people. I've been around, you know, one or two generations of Mad, I would say at this point. So, you know, the divide in my followers is insane. You know, I have people who are 30 years old, and I have people who are 14. And because I guess I've ranked high enough on the stupid ass algorithm that it's being pushed to new feeds to this day, which is true. My numbers are steady strong. I haven't posted a video in like over a year. It's 1.5 mil a month. And that doesn't make a lot of money, by the way, folks who are listening. It really, really doesn't. It doesn't make living wage, that's for damn sure.
Absolutely not. Yeah, but
Not
it's nice
even
to have passive
close.
income at least.
Oh,
Even if even
absolutely.
like
Yeah, a
even
little bit.
$10 is like, hey, all right, there's
Yeah.
lunch.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, a little bit of extra is just like, oh, you know, maybe I'm making that time back and some of that suffering. But yeah, no, it's
But yeah, so you just sound of that introspection about yourself and where you're going and seeing,
Yeah, and
and.
I don't know where it is, right? Like, it's tough as an artist, because you know that people only care about what you're doing for the most part now, or was. It's always like that. No one wanted to hear Snoop Dogg make a reggae album. Like, I know it sounds like a joke, and it kind of is, but it's the truth, right? You want to hear Snoop Dogg rap like a motherfucker. You don't want to hear the reggae album. You don't give a fuck. Some people did. 10, 15% maybe, but that's the way it
Yeah, the
is, you
majority
know.
is not.
And so it's a tough balance as an artist, because I can spend as much time on a piece of 3D as a shitpost, but no one's gonna give a shit. A couple people will, just a couple, but not a lot.
Not
And
the
it's tough,
mass.
because I guess it's tough in a way, because it's like, you know, I shouldn't care about that acceptance of it, but when you kind of it's kind of there, or you want a lot of people to see it because you're proud of it, you know, it can hurt on a different level, you know what I mean?
When you put your heart into something and it doesn't perform, there's so crushing.
Yeah, and I guess it's also shitty when like things have performed that you feel like
Yeah,
shouldn't.
it's
You
like,
hear
why
this
the
from a lot of
fuck is this
artists.
successful?
You hear this from a lot of artists on Twitter, right? They're like, oh, the art piece that I put 40 hours into, it has 3 retweets, and then it's the shit post that's the 3 second, you know, like Squirtle with the sunglasses that says something, so you know, 50,000 retweets or something. And that's so fucking crushing, man. Like,
It's just how it
because,
is.
and it's true, because you know people care about humor, but you know it's tough when you've tasted that, and a lot of people I don't think have the capacity for dealing with that, right? You're like, well, why the fuck? You know, there's a couple of entertainers that I've seen on the internet have fallen into that, where they're like, this is what people find funny, and that's all they make.
Becomes kind of
I won't, yeah, I won't
soulless.
name any of them, not just because it's, I'm only not naming these people because I don't think anyone knows who I'm talking about. But there's a couple of people where it's just like, you've made the same video basically for like the last like 10 years, or like 4 or 5 years. Like, stop it. And it's still working for the most part, but it's like, stop it.
Yeah,
You know,
you want to
it's.
see them grow as a creator, but you know,
Yeah.
they are sticking to what works, and I mean that's again, it's the bread and butter issue. Like if they have the time, they could experiment with something new, but you know it's not going to be successful unless it's a fluke.
Yeah, I mean, because it's tough. It's tough even breaking in, and it's tough to venture. You know, just as well as I do, it's tough to break in, and you know. I don't. And the sad reality is that if back in the day, if one or two of my videos didn't blow up, right, I probably still wouldn't have been making videos. You know, I have a lot of love for all the fans and all the cool people. I hate using the word fucking fans too, but you know, like, what am I gonna say? I'm not gonna say people. Like,
Yeah, the viewer,
sounds kind of
you
weird.
know.
The viewer, like, because I've met so many people at cons, or like people DM me, or like I got the sweetest fucking DM the other day that just like killed me. They're like, you know, I get them a lot, and it makes me like want to do this forever.
Yeah.
And it was, let's see if I can open it. I'm gonna summarize it though. I don't wanna.
Yeah.
It's not long.
A dramatic reading of a DM.
Yeah.
By MowtenDoo.
It's not long, but I don't wanna like someone saying something
really
nice.
Personal. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, those moments for me too are I think the most valuable when someone really when I get an email that tells me that somebody went out of their way to find my email address and email me.
Yeah.
And like that means the world. It really does.
Yeah, this one. About 4 years ago, you retrieved a picture of a 3D model I was making. And because I retweeted it, and like I said, I'm sorry, because I don't want to read this person's very hurtful message. You made me think my art was not bad, and thus I kept doing 3D art, and I just got accepted into a good university for 3D art.
Hell yeah.
And like, I was like, oh my God, like, I'm going to cry. Like,
yeah. But you know, like
all I care about now, I think, is making a difference.
Yeah.
Honestly, like I want to make a good difference for people.
Yeah.
And I played with the idea of a tutorial channel for a long time. All right. I still am. People have been asking. I tweeted about it once, and people still poke me about it.
So yeah, maybe that's
I want to do it, but you know, I have my own. It still falls into like the, you know, I need to. It definitely would make a lot of money. Funny enough.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. It'd be profitable
because it's the whole 10-minute. You know.
Right, you'd go the full gamut and be able to advertise as appropriate.
And sponsors, etc. Yeah, but. It's the imposter syndrome where I don't feel like I have a right to be teaching
right,
people
you
things.
Know, I'm just a generalist. I'm not an expert at anything. Who am I to teach?
And even then, like, who the fuck wants to hear my opinion on how After Effects works when I don't feel like I'm that good at it?
Right, right.
You know, a lot of people who are listening or, you know, this and that disagree. But, you know, there's always the higher mountain to climb.
Right.
No matter what.
If you are listening and you want to hear it, hit him on Twitter and let him know in the comments that you want his tutorial. So he'll,
yeah, you know, the name of the channel is Tutorials.
Oh, I love it.
I knew you'd appreciate
yeah,
that.
Yeah, dude, that's fantastic.
Yeah, no, I mean, and I have a document for it that I've crafted out a big list of them.
Yo, before you know this video is done, make sure that you go and like you've already got the channel like reserved. Yeah.
That doesn't mean shit on YouTube anymore because it's a channel ID.
True. Yeah. Yeah.
So like back in the day.
Well, for me it matters because it's like YouTube/C/Stanpai. I don't want someone else having that.
They can have it. I don't fucking care. Like it doesn't bother me. If you guys want it, you can have it.
Well, all right, you got his consent now.
Like, yeah, it doesn't bother me.
That's cool, dude. Yeah, that's I look for. I think especially because it's so, like then you know there are so many tutorials out there, but you fill a very unique niche because of the kind of content you've made.
Yeah,
you have a specific kind of viewer.
Yeah, I think that's where the fun of it would be. Was just like I'm not gonna teach you the same old shit. Probably.
Right.
Like I feel like I use After Effects wrong, but the good kind of wrong.
Yeah. Now you freestyle. It's like Fist of the North Star. Everyone's got their own unique way of fighting. this is Doofist.
Oh, there's been some shit. Like you should like. Oh man. You know when you're like doing, you know you're doing something wrong.
Yeah.
And it's like it's kind of working, but it's you're like, no, this is wrong.
This is how I do it.
Yeah, but it, and it's working, and it's just like, but there's no other way you could probably get that result other than doing it wrong.
Right. Well, I mean,
it's just like,
you know, look at David Wise, right? Donkey Kong Country.
Yeah.
And he was not trained musically. He did not have music theory. He composed, you know, that soundtrack. And there's a great YouTube channel called 8-Bit Music Theory. They cover this sort of thing. And it's where I heard this. He broke the rules of music theory with Aquatic Ambience. It does not follow the rules. Because of things he did with the chords specifically and notes, but it's one of the greatest tracks.
Yeah.
You know, and so sometimes that level of freedom and willingness to not just adhere. I mean, look, nobody looks at Picasso's work for the realism he did when he was a kid.
Yeah.
They all look at his abstract.
No, I agree fully. I feel like, you know, if everyone's taught the same thing, everyone's going to do the same thing. I mentioned a tweet like this a while back where I was like, you know, people are like, what is the highest level of art? Like, it's drawing photoreal, right? Like 100%. Like that's what a lot of people regard as like, this is what I want to do. I want to be able to draw the photoreal bullshit, right? Like, you can't, it's indistinguishable. And that's just like, well, if everyone else got to that level, then all art would be boring and right. The same. Like, and I feel like, you know, if everyone's taught that way, then everyone, you know, I don't know if you ever heard of the quote unquote CalArts style.
Oh God,
of drawing.
Yeah.
Right. But, you know, because maybe they come out of that school sort of thing. And for those who are listening who don't know, there's the current, everyone's complaining about the style of Cartoon Network currently.
It's all the same art style.
And most of the people who are working on the shows there come out of CalArts in California, which is an art school. And that's how that is. But, you know, when you bullshit it, you learn things so fucking differently.
Yeah.
You know, and once again, segueing back, you know, working on the worst possible footage and having to invent things with completely incorrect footage makes your idea for making things so much brighter and deeper, especially when you're given something that's perfect and clean. You know, I can clean up and roto faster than a lot of people because I've rotoed garbage.
Right.
Like the hardest, most difficult thing to roto that if you gave to someone with a top skill level, they wouldn't know how to touch because they're like, what the fuck?
They're like, why am I working with this footage? Get me new footage.
Yeah. Whereas it's like, this is all I have.
Right. You have to do it.
And then, you know, you give me like something else that needs to be rotoed where it's, you know, 1080p footage. I can roto 1080p footage fucking quick and easy and good.
Yeah. But now you were in the trenches. That's what made you, you know, made you your... you don't like to say a master, but I mean, I'm really a master at your style of art.
Yeah, like you it gives you the, it's the hard, it's, you dug a hole with a spoon.
Yeah.
It's a lot easier to dig a hole once you get the shovel and even easier once you get the front loader.
Yeah.
But, you know, you did it the hard way. So, you know, the nuances to dig in that hole with the spoon to keep it up at right. Whereas the, you know, the person, they go at the front loader, they like dig the hole and it collapses on itself, you know?
Right.
You get that, the little things, you know, I taught a music engineer that reverb smooths audio. They didn't know. They weren't a very good music engineer. They were actually one though. Cause that was a ytpmv trick, right? You stretch the fuck out of a track, you throw reverb on it. It's just, and now, you know, it's probably, this is a few years back, you know, because that's the way Paul Stretch works. Paul Stretch just reverbs over itself to stretch the fuck out of audio cleaner. And so it works as a trick for smoothing. It muddies the audio, but, I mean, it works.
Yeah, it takes something that was unworkable and makes it workable.
Yeah, a little bit better. Dude. But, yeah, like, it's you know, the lowest tier, the hardest thing to work with. Is going to make you grow so much faster than the I have the perfectly ready keyed out footage, or fuck it, you give me the footage with the alpha channel already, like it's like halfway ready to go.
Yeah,
I do a lot of thinking when I'm doing roto because I'm sitting there and I'm just like fixing up, cutting it out and shit every frame and next frame and while I'm doing that, you know, I'm zoning out and I'm thinking, you know, what could I do with this, like,
right? Yeah, you get a chance to explore it.
Yeah, I have a break of like half an hour, where I'm still working on the project, but like I have a break in thought where I can dream a little bit, right? Because if I give you a perfectly ready piece of footage, you put it down and then you're like, okay, what can I do with this?
Right.
And you sit there for 10 minutes, but you're exploring it too much, right? You can't dream because you're like, I need to think of something that needs to be done, but I can't do that while I'm sitting there like a dumbass, you know, rotoing it slowly because I'm doing the work that allows me to do stuff.
Right.
Like, so I'm
it lets
there,
you think. Da-da-da-da-da.
Yeah. You know, cutting, but add a point, move the point.
Yeah. Well, and that's the thing you were talking about earlier. And you were saying about once you master something like the high level fighting game, you don't think about the rotoing so much as you are thinking about other things while you're rotoing.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's what happens to me. I zone out when I roto.
Yeah,
I'm just
trance.
Like, Yeah, because I just know point goes here, point goes here. I move the handle here. I move this point. Next frame, go. Or, you know, it's like 3 day ways to roto. This is probably someone watching this like, no, you don't roto every frame. I'm like, yeah, you're right.
But that's how I
depends.
Do it.
Yeah. Not always. Depends. There's a few methods. I know the one where you start frame, end frame, and then you find the frame that they're the most off, and then you fill fix in that in, one. Yeah.
Like a key,
and then there's another framing. One that's, yeah, and then there's another one that's every 5 frames. There's a few ways. There's no
exact technique. It's like any kind of art and image editing. There are multiple ways to tackle the problem.
Yeah, probably every frame is bad, though. That's more of a roto brush thing.
Yeah, it's just less efficient. Brush.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're here for optimization. We're not here for daydreaming.
Yeah, that's what keyframing daydream is for.
Dude, I think you should definitely go forward with that tutorial stuff.
I want to, because like, I have so many people, like, they always tell me, you know, it's just like, you inspire me or this and that, and I'm just like, oh my God, like, that is so much more important than everything else to me, honest to God.
Yeah.
Like, I don't care about the views, and I don't care about, like, you know, like, I want people to see it, but I don't care about the numbers, you know?
Yeah,
you
care about how it made them feel as an individual.
Exactly, and that's like Rust in Peace, for instance.
Yeah.
Like,
that's 100%. That's the same way I feel. I tell people all the time, I'd rather see a comment than, you know, extra views.
Exactly. You know, and it's like that. You know, someone told me, there's like, I can't believe that you've... Someone said after they watched Wrestling Peace, I think it was a few weeks later, it's like, I can't believe you've managed to invoke every emotion I've had throughout, like, your channel, right? And I like, that sounds like I'm, like, stroking my ego, but, like, that to me was...
That's what he said.
Was touching to me, though, right? Like, that's like... That was like... That wasn't my intention of my channel or anything, but I realized it after. He's like, you made me laugh. You made me, like, fucking, like, yeah, this is awesome. And then it's like, that video, because like, you made me cry. And I was like, fuck.
You did it.
But that wasn't my intention either, right?
Right,
like,
you were just making something from the heart.
I'm just making stuff. Yeah, I don't usually make videos to make people laugh. Sometimes I'll put a joke in, right? But, you know, I make mads because I like mads.
Yeah, that's all it is.
The newcomer finds it really funny. Like, the newcomers, when they see Gachi, is hilarious. And then you have the old school Gachi people. They're like, they're sitting there with a fine tune comb. Like,
right. You're like,
what are you doing with these samples? And they're like, you know, we don't laugh at Gachi anymore. When we started with Gachi, we would laugh at Gachi. We would laugh at Gachi now when there's jokes. When you do a good Gachi joke, that's hilarious. But back, you know,
the shock value is gone.
Brand new. People are brand new to MAD. We'll always laugh at the videos, right? No, they don't know why. It's not funny, like, but it is, because, like, what the hell is going on?
It's the absurdity of it, you know? But you get so desensitized to the absurdity that you only can laugh when it's intentionally, like, designed to make you laugh.
And then that's, I think, where it gets interesting, right? Because then that's the fighting game thing that we're talking about, where you don't think at the start, and then you think, and then you don't think.
Yeah.
Right? It goes back to the three levels of thought, mm-hmm. where...
I spend more time, because I have the resource packs that have so many of the already green screened sources, you know, thanks to everybody who made those. So most of my time, as I said earlier, goes to finding, going like basically needle in a haystack, because I've got hundreds of files, right?
Yeah, which is tough too, right? Yeah, because I have sample packs for audio. That, and it's not just like Gachi and all that. It's like, we're talking like music, like percussion.
Yeah.
I don't know where the fuck to start.
So, like, I'm going through and I'm listening one by one and watching one by one on all these fucking sources. And what ends up happening sometimes is, because I know what I'm looking for, but I find what I'm not looking for. And, like, that becomes the missing piece of the puzzle.
Oh, God. For me, that becomes a distraction. Because now I'm like, I really want this type of snare drum, right? If I'm doing audio. And I find another one, and it's like it's completely different. I'm like, wait a minute, what if I use this one? And then everything goes to hell. Everything completely goes to hell, because now my idea, again, this is an ADHD symptom that I have. It's now it's like, what if I use this instead? And then like my original idea for the music track is now different,
right?
Because I added this snare drum, and now everything is hell, because, you know,
it all falls apart.
Yeah, because if you start playing around, and you start going through packs. It's also
time sync.
Not just that, but it's based on. It's based on the organizational methods of your pack, because you're way less likely, if you don't know what you want, you're not going to choose the thing at the end of the pack most likely, because you found it beforehand, which means that you've artificially limited what you want to use.
I go through
it's like
every
speed runners. I do that with typefaces. It's like speedrunners are really, really fucking good at the start of the game. If they don't use save states for the end of the game, their practice level is 100% at the start and tapers to like 20% at the end because they usually restart the run until they hit the end.
Right.
It works the same way.
Damn. Dude, for me, the only convenience is that when I'm looking for a clip, it's because I already know in my head what I want to use for a specific part, but I have gaps still in the other parts. Mm-hmm. And that's where I see, oh, that's what goes there, you know? It's like I find the puzzle pieces that I didn't look for yet. That's for me how that works. Oh, man.
My best work has been giving the least amount of fucks.
Yeah.
And I this dawned on me a couple of months ago, and it fucked me up. Because that's the flow, right?
Yeah, you just
But flow
you
for
just
me
do.
Is... Yeah, flow for me is just stop thinking. So we were talking about the Super Spice Bros part, like the last half of it. I just was just like, ha, I'm feeling manic, and I edited it, boom, 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 and I'm like, I love this.
Yeah.
Kept it. One of the gacha collabs I did where I did Undertale.
Yeah, the Underground. I was going to ask about that.
Bodybuilder
from the Underground.
I got manic and put Commando in it, and I love that. It makes me happy.
I'm glad that you did, and I'm also glad that Blaz picked up where that left off. Proper.
Yeah, that was also one of, like, that was the collab before.
Yeah,
that was peak burnout for me. That was the collab before last because of what I mentioned is was that a double collab? I don't think that year was a double
in regards to you doing Japanese and Western. What do you mean by double?
Yeah, by Japanese and Western.
Well, didn't they... Which year did the Japanese take a year off?
2015.
Yeah.
Or 14. No, that wasn't a double, but that was peak finals for me.
Okay.
And I was so overworked in school because my school is... My former school is very, very well known for doing that.
Crunch.
That I actually broke down to the point where I could not force myself to work anymore. Like, uh-huh. I honestly, like, it was actually not possible.
You hit the limit.
I hit, like, a mental and physical limit. I even went to my, I can't. Like, I honestly, like, I will, I cannot make myself do it. Like, and it's weird to hear, right? Unless you've experienced this.
Yeah.
It's like, no, yeah, you can. It's like, no.
No, you really, like, you stop.
You tell yourself to do it, and then your body and your mind is telling you, no, you're not going to.
It just doesn't work. You physically, like, your performance is an incapable performance.
Even, you can't even start it.
Yeah,
that's the, like your mind is fighting itself. It's just like, I need to do this. I need to do it. I need, but I can't. But I need to. But I can't. But I can't. And it's a weird thing, you know. And crunch just fucks you up.
Yeah.
In general, like, for months.
Yeah, and crunch really needs to be limited to short sprints. It can't be a persistent thing.
Yeah. And that would have been fine with the school, but I packed school with...
collaboration.
Yeah, which was like crunch into crunch.
Yeah.
And mentioning I think it was the collab before that one, I think it was one of the worst years. Because I went into... I was driven to kill myself at one point with these, for sure. I wanted to test my limits, and I regret this more than anything. Don't, like, do this,
don't
by the
do
way.
It.
Don't test your limits. Anyone who's listening, like, really honestly don't. It's like, oh, yeah, I'll hit my limit, then I'll know my limit. No. You'll hurt yourself doing it. One of the years was finals, plus it was Super Mario collab, the Mario Disco, which was November, with finals, and then Western and Eastern gotcha in the span of a month or 2 months.
Overload.
Oh, yeah. I don't do it.
Yeah.
I've hurt myself. Like, I am not well anymore, honestly, from a lot of these things.
You know,
and a lot of the collabs. Yeah, no, I have not. A few of the collabs I have not recovered from. I'm sure a lot of people who listen who know what I'm talking about. Like, I've not recovered. And I don't think I ever will.
you know, and it's not just the personal mental like abuse and physical abuse, but also the like the social element when it's that level of pressure. I first met you at MAGFest.
Yeah,
that was the first time we ever met, and actually the only time we've ever met. And that was in the midst of IWF production. And I remember the atmosphere at the time was very, because like you were kind of radio silent on and off, and you know there was like a frustration. It's like, why is he hanging out at a convention? We have a deadline, you know. And I think there's like a misunderstanding that people need a fucking break, you know. Like,
I mean, I had panels I had to do there.
Yeah, like it was professional too.
Game developer. Yeah, I had like game developer panels. Like, I didn't just and I had like plane tickets already booked like a month beforehand. So kind of set in stone.
Right.
I mean, I'm not innocent. I'm not. No fucking way. Like, I will clear that. Like, I fucked up. For like those who are listening don't know, like, I was the reason why that collab was delayed 2 weeks. I'll fess up to that. I bit off more than I could chew, because that was, as we mentioned earlier, it was going to be my last hurrah. And honestly, what I did achieve in the time that it is fucking insane.
Yeah.
But I don't, like I said, I don't think I've ever recovered from that in a lot of ways. Actually, I think I started smoking because of that one. Wow. Actually, I'm almost certain I started smoking. I quit recently. Wow. But I think that was the reason I started smoking. But I hurt myself really fucking bad because I wanted to make the greatest thing ever made. And I tried the fucking best. And I think it turned out pretty good.
It did. No, yeah, it's definitely like for exactly what it is, it's very good.
I mean, you saw me at MAG, though.
Yeah.
I probably didn't look well.
Well, you had your mask on and all, so I don't know.
Yeah, but maybe if you looked me in the eyes.
Yeah, like closely, you know, I didn't know you. I didn't know you enough to be able to tell the difference. Also, because, like, that con killed me, dude.
That con is nuts.
I got so sick.
you want to know my level of fucking dedication?
Tell us.
I went to the con with it still pending, right? I didn't have a choice, like I said.
Yeah.
Fucking everyone mad at me, whatever. Came back. I got sick.
Yeah.
Because you get sick at cons.
Yeah.
I continued to work on that project. Sick. Very sick. Like, incredibly sick.
Yeah.
Like I was already burnt out, but I was like fever dream, like shaking sick.
Yeah, dude, believe me, if it was anything like I got from that convention, then I'd have nothing but pity for what you're telling me right now.
I submitted the final part and render of all that at 3 a.m. sick as a fucking dog, like shaking and sweating with like fever and like hallucinating. I don't, like, I'm not saying this, like, for pity, but, like...
It was terrible.
But it's just more that, like, don't work like that, people who are listening. Don't.
Like, in hindsight, deadlines, you know, they're important for structure and maintenance, and nobody wants to be late, but I came to realize, especially looking back, when it comes out, people will remember in the immediate that it's delayed, but... Aside from those who were directly impacted by it, nobody cares that it was delayed now. I mean...
I agree, yeah.
You know?
but still, like... And it's tough because, you know, you let everyone else down.
Right,
and
it's a team effort.
Yeah, and so it makes you feel like shit. Like, it's just... That's just how it goes. I felt like shit for a long time. Yeah. I still kind of do. Like, I've been... I shot for the moon, and that was a little bit too far to shoot.
Well, I don't know. Didn't Aniki like fly past the moon in that? Or Miku rather? Miku like
did he went into the stars? Yeah. No, I mean I mean like I said, I'll 100% admit it. I bit off more than I could shoot.
Yeah.
But that goes back to what I was saying before with the passion, right?
Yeah.
I wanted to make the coolest thing ever. As like the, hey, this is the last time I'm going to do this. And it very quickly spiraled out of control.
Yeah.
Because that's too much. It's too much work to model and rig two full characters in a month and a half's time.
That's
And
true. There were new models.
model rig, animate, and do all the landscape. The entire thing is from scratch, man. Except for like one, two assets, three assets. Okay. The steamroller,
Miku.
Kasuna Eye, and Miku, yeah.
Yeah.
Everything else was done from scratch. All the lighting, all that. Honestly, it probably would have been fine if V-Ray wasn't a piece of shit. Fuck V-Ray anyway. Like, I don't use V-Ray anymore. Fuck V-Ray. I mean, it sucks because, like, like a lot of people there, I know they mutter it behind the scenes, the render times, blah, blah, blah. Like, it was the combination of the worst possible things in 3D all at once, which is outdoors, moving camera, and, like, all that. Like, moving camera already sucks. Like, moving camera, like, chasing something sucks in 3D. Like, it's a pain in the ass. And outdoor scenes are hell.
Dude, it
And when
was
you combine
so
both of
funny,
those.
the render farm that everybody was part of.
Yeah. I don't know if this is knowledge, but behind the scenes, I was working with one of the people, and we put money down. That part actually cost me money.
The inside scoop. I'll tell you, like, that's another thing though, so you mentioned like your goal, you know, you saw the mountain was to be part of it, you know, when you first had seen it, and then you got in touch with Kanai and everybody. Like, for me, I had a similar goal, and that reaction video, the first one I did, which was for 2016, is really what got me connected to the gacha community, as like an entity. You know, I existed, and that's how I got invited. And for me, it was like the same thing. Like, I set a goal. Like, I really want to be in part of IWF, and I got to be part of it. I got to make commercials, and that was the level of my involvement I wanted. But seeing behind the scenes, the production of start to finish from when I came in to the day of release was really eye-opening about what really happens. Project management. And seeing, you know, who is and is not relative to every single position that's filled, people don't understand how much true production work goes into these things.
They're hell projects. I tell everyone, I go, a lot of people, I'm thinking about doing a collab. I'm like, good fucking luck. And not like saying they can't do it, but I'm like, you're
Welcome
gonna
to
have
the
a
rock show,
time.
dude.
Yeah, like I've been in a lot of collabs, a lot. I have my little list here somewhere in my bookmarks. I have all the Google Docs saved of them. When they were put in the Google Excel sheets, I
Yeah.
saved them just to save them. Yeah,
Memento.
I've been like eight or ten, collabs. Some people now they have me beat, sure. I mean, there's been a lot. But they're stressful. Yeah, not even if you're like the one, who people are looking down on, but you're looking at the other person who's like, you're getting close. You're getting close to the deadline, man.
Yeah.
Or like you want it because you want it to be great. You want the entire thing to be great. Especially if it's something you care about like gotcha. You want it to be
Yeah.
the best fucking thing everyone's ever seen altogether. And so there's a lot of blood, sweat, and tears that go into those projects. And, like I said, a lot of people don't participate anymore on them because they've hit that point of like, I care about this too much.
Yeah.
I'm going to die.
Yeah. I
Like,
saw specific people go through that during that particular project.
yeah, and it happens a lot. It happens a lot. And it's the funny thing about that is that's it's more of a Western collab thing.
Yeah.
All the Japanese guys, they don't talk to each other, man.
It's just strictly business.
They post a video and everyone goes like, that's fucking cool, and then that's it. Like there's no talking. I was in the Skype group when all the collabs were in Skype. And I think I was doing both Western and Eastern at the same time, or there was the gap between the two or the 6 months, and no one talked in the Japanese one, except when they posted. They go Ezo, Ezo.
Hazel, Hazel.
Yeah, right. Every time you post it, because and that's it. And then when it posts, everyone's like, "Good job, everyone!" And I'm like, "What the fuck?" And then I'd go to sleep while I'm doing a Western one, and I wake up and there'd be 600 messages.
Right.
And it's all random shit.
Yeah, it was just conversation.
Or critiques, and you know.
Like, yeah, and it gets lost in the conversation.
And a lot of people, everyone's from different countries, so the people.
The language barrier.
Will take things differently. Yeah, yeah. Like, they all speak English, but I was going to mention this earlier, like, you know, some people will say something that can be interpreted differently.
Yeah.
I know this is, for instance, people from Nordic countries, for instance, because I've been working with Nords recently. They sound like assholes, but they're not trying to be. It's just like, I had someone, they messaged me earlier, and they finished with, "All right, bro." Right? It's like, I read that like,
all right, piss bro. Them up,
but I know. Yeah, but that's all you said, because I said, "Hey, I'm going to do this." You go, "All right, bro." Right? And if I said that to you after you said something, you'd be like, "The fuck did I do?" But no, it's just like, it's different, right?
All right,
I
bro.
Know that's not what they mean. Right? Yeah. Like, but so stuff like that, and it can get lost when you have 60 countries, or, you know, that's 60, obviously that's a place, but you know, there's
yeah,
7, 8, 9, 10,
let
and,
alone
know,
the
speaks...
entire Obama Island.
Yeah, and you have, you know, it's all different styles of English, basically.
Yeah.
It stuff happens, and you know,
that's something,
hear things differently.
I'm very curious about to hear that, the differences aside from that, between the Eastern and Western collabs behind the scenes. You're one of the few people who can really talk about that.
Yeah. It's strictly fucking business and no talking. Like I said, they submit, they work slightly with each other. I've done audio and video in a collab, and we talk transitions with the part, and it's like, "Hey, I'm going to do this to your part." Cool. You know, he rented me, I forget who it was who did it. I think it was Yakitori. No, he was the one before me. He gave me an AVI with an alpha. He's like, "This is how I'm going to transition here. Trust it." And I did it. I'm like, "Cool, that's awesome." That was when I did Senbon.
Uh-huh.
And it went into Kantai Collection. And I went to Pirates of the Caribbean theme. And the big skull, like, uh-huh, closed down on the thing as a transition. He sent me that as an AVI. He's like, "Test it." And I'm like, "Oh, that's awesome. Cool." It's like, "Great, it's not good, like, go or no." And that was it. It's the end of that conversation. And I've had people do the audio for me, and we like talked a tiny bit. He's like, "Hey, like, let me show you what I got." He's like, "Oh," and then he would mess with me, like, "Hey, oh, I changed this." And then, of course, they don't speak English,
right?
So it's all broken as fuck English, but it's no more than I think anyone else talked to each other on the parts,
right?
That's... you're just given something, and you know that's what you're given, and you fucking work with it, and you go.
Yeah.
And sometimes, you know, you ask for a small change, or like, "Hey, what was this? What were you using as this audio sample here? Oh, this. Oh, thank you." Boom, it's done. Posted, it goes. You don't see any of the parts. I didn't see any of the parts in the Japanese one, really.
Until it was done.
I think for the most part, I think there was a finished version, or like, you saw like some of the compile, but it wasn't like people posted their parts, really. Like, they did sometimes, but a lot of the parts were just like, I didn't see shit. Like, yeah. I didn't see anything of it. But very little communication, and they just happened.
Right.
They just worked.
How would you compare the discipline then also? I mean, that's a lot of independence. Would you say that's just a part of the culture? It's like a lot more disciplined for the Japanese creators to just do their shit and be expected to deliver?
I think so. They didn't critique, and I think I always think back to this. I did critique one person. I'm like, "Man, I hope I didn't sound like an ass." Because it's a different culture.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
It's a very, very different working culture, and if you mention something like that, it could be seen as offensive.
Right.
And I don't know if it was taken that way, or they're like, "Haha, funny gaijin."
Uh-huh.
"Haha, funny gaijin, go brr." like, you know.
That's actually, we were talking about memes earlier. That's definitely a contemporary.
That's a go one, though.
Yeah.
Let that one live forever.
Yeah. The other is, I'm not even going to mention it. I don't want to give it any more screen time.
But, like, I think it's definitely different. I've worked with a few. I mean, I did Pepsi Man with Noma. I hit him up, "Hey, I want you to do this." Okay. He sent me a demo. I'm like, "Wow, this is awesome." I wish I didn't lose it, because I have actually two versions of Pepsi Man. The first one was completely different. I'm like, "This is awesome." And then he messaged me the next day, right? I was like, "Oh, I didn't like the other version. Here's this one." It's like the finished version of Pepsi Man here now. This isn't a day between the messages.
Yeah.
He was like, "Holy fucking shit, this is awesome. Like, this is perfect." He's like, "Great." And I was like, "Wow, fuck. That's there was no critiques. I didn't have to tell him what to do. He gave it to me. It was awesome. I just said, hey, I want you to work with me. Like, I want a really, really crazy version of, like, just make the Pepsi Man team fucking insane. And he's like, okay. And he did it. And I was happy. And I didn't work with him any more than that.
Yeah.
The most I've ever worked or critiqued or fucked with that was Noma again on the Octagon collab, 8 Awesome Angles of YouTube, but that's a little bit different. Because he's the medley maker.
Right.
And I can't speak for the last collab because I wasn't on it. I'm really happy to see that he returned, though. That made me very happy. Because the Brain Power Noma Pepsi Man thing was like before Brain Power / right when it was kind
of
going up.
Right. It was in the early days of that particular source or reference. Yeah.
I'm really happy that he got on the latest Octagon Club, which knocked it out of the fucking park. Yeah. It was so good. I was so happy to see him.
Eight
on
straight
it.
Minutes like, was awesome. Like, yes. I was really good. Happy with the choices they made and what content to feature.
Yeah.
Octavania was my favorite part.
I think if I heard from some people, because I actually have, surprisingly, I haven't been on a collab in 2 years, but I hear a lot of the back workings on most of the collabs, which I do. I think there was disagreements on some of the songs on that one, but of course there is all the time. Yeah, it's really hard to please people.
Right.
Taste. You know, that's another thing that I think a lot of people don't realize on collabs like that, right? You invite X amount of people. Everyone has to agree on the songs.
Yeah.
For the most part, right? Otherwise, you have the one guy who's really pissed off that, like, Star Maze wasn't in it. You know, and he's pissed off as hell. You know, and so you're trying to figure out a good way to do it because there's depending on the size of the project, you know, potentially 30 people. And then, you better hope you get your fucking part.
Yeah, right? You hope it doesn't get assigned to someone else.
Yeah, I'm listening to the medley or because I think it depends on the collab. Sometimes it's assigned pre-medley and then sometimes it's post-medley.
Uh-huh.
Depends the collab. There's nothing. And I'll talk about actually how medley or how collabs are put together for the people who are still listening.
Yeah.
But, you know, a lot of the times, you vibe with a part and you're like, I need this part. But there's 3 other people who want that part.
Yeah.
And depending on the collab, like, it is sectioned differently where, you know, it's a pick your top three.
Right.
Round robin. But sometimes you can put heads, man, because, you know, like...
I want this part. Well, I want this part.
I
want to
do the final... Yeah, I want to do the Final Fantasy part, goddammit. And then, of course, you're working with someone else, usually with the audio.
Yeah.
And sometimes they might not feel else. Their audio.
Yeah.
Which I've had a couple of times. I'm not feeling it. I'm not going to tell them, but, like, it'll hinder the work. That's right. Why I always try and work with certain people on collabs, too. Where I'm just like, because even if you don't feel the audio, the visuals ain't going to happen.
Yeah. It has to sync.
Yeah. For most people who don't know, general, there's, like I said, there's no, like, set in stone. But usually, you know, you recruit all the people for a collab and we'll say it's 10 songs, it's going to be 20-25 people because you're going to have half the people working on audio ideally, and you'll have the audio makers who are really good at audio, they work on audio, and then all the video makers who work on video, and then you guys maybe talk amongst yourselves about like, we want to feature these videos or these songs, you know, maybe you vote whatever, and then you get the medley maker or makers. By the way, it's better when it's just one.
This yeah, I 100% 100% agree. Yeah.
One medley maker, IWF, one. you know, they work on it, and you figure it out, and then it's passed along to the audio people, and the audio people, they work on it, and hopefully the audio people are talking to the video people.
Right, like, we didn't even discuss what they were going to do.
Yeah, sometimes you just get it. And then the video people work on their parts, and hopefully the video people are talking with the video people who are before and after them so that they transition cleaner. Same with the audio people, but the audio is a lot easier to clean up than it is the video in that case. Because audio, you can, if you have the person who's mastering it, they can just do really easy transitions because you have the stems. There's no video stems. Video is a shut format, usually like an MP3.
Yeah.
You can't master an MP3 really. And then, you know, there's all the other shit that happens, but yeah, it's a lot of work, man. There, and there's a lot of people. Sometimes you have the quote unquote the automat generalist, I guess, or they do one audio part, they do one video part, or they'll do their audio part and their video part. Depends. It depends, right? Like, I've done that on a collab. I've done my own audio and video. I've done a completely different audio part.
Right.
In a video
for someone else,
and then a
video
part. Yeah, I did that on one of the not the Danjiris. I think it was the summer one. It was the one I did Senbon. I did the audio for the part before it, which was Snow Goose, one of my best audios in my opinion, ever. And then it immediately transitioned into my part, which I did. No, it wasn't Senbon. It was the Pokemon one.
Chin Pokemon.
It was Chin Pokemon, yeah. And that was my first IWF or my
first Danjiri.
Danjiri, yeah. Huh? Yeah.
I made a I made a parody with that earlier this year.
I think you showed it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Did I do? I think I did audio. They're like, we need audio. I was like, I do audio too. Like, okay. I was like, cool. Thank you, MowtenDoo-san. I love them. I miss them so much. They're such good people. Yeah. I'm kind of friends with a couple of them. I mean, I don't speak English, or like I interact with them. Some of them, Astro Titan G is a great person. I love him. A lot of them have moved on. They're not really on Twitter. Kanai is still going strong.
Still doing things. Yeah.
And that goes back to the have fun versus the visuals, right? Because all he has is the video clips that are just cutting 20 times, right? But he does it so perfectly well. And it's like the lowest level of visuals, but it works super duper well because he knows the discipline for cutting clips. You know, for those who, like, the person I'm talking about is usually, if you've seen any Pokemon video that is like Route 6 or any of that with Gachi, it's him. he's a legend. And he's very nice as well. They've all been super duper nice to me. And they, you know, he's still making videos to this day. I think he's one of the last ones left. But, you know, and you enjoy it. And he still makes other mads too. He makes some good Idolmaster ones.
Like overall, his avatar is people. Even.
Yeah. Like, I love them. And yeah, I miss the simpler times for sure, right? Like,
I think this year was a very good return to form for the Danjiri.
Yeah?
Yeah, I really enjoyed it. I mean, aside from having the two teams thing, I think there was just a lot of fun stuff that kind of reminded, I hopefully reminded people that bigger isn't always better when it comes to, like, Flash. But that's,
oh yeah, I agree. It's the fun. Like, have fun with your projects and don't overthink it. And, you know, like, just because you can doesn't mean you should.
Right. Yeah, that's 100% the truth.
Like, I have quote unquote held my power level back for a long time, and it's not because I'm trying to hold my power level back. It's because I don't need to render this crazy 3D ass part for a certain part because it doesn't.
It's not necessary.
You know, yeah. I did for the last co-op, and everyone saw what, like, at that time, what I was capable of. But, like, I never put that in my normal videos because fucking why?
They destroy you.
I don't need, but it just doesn't work either. Like, I don't need 3D Terry Crews, you know, doing a funny joke here and there. Like, it'll impress people, but, like, it doesn't fit the, you know, Mario
video. It's not cohesive.
Or something. Yeah, like, it just because it's there and it's flashy, it doesn't make better.
Yeah.
It doesn't. You know, a piece of shit with glitter on it is still a piece of shit.
Yeah.
and I think that's the important thing that I think a lot of people need to realize is just like, the whole thing will be better in that case.
Yeah.
You know, it's like if a movie has, it's a really good example actually I just thought of, you know. A bad movie with a budget of $50 million or $500 million is still going to be a bad movie.
Yeah.
It, you know, like, it doesn't matter how cool the visual effects are, like, it'll still suck. You
Right.
know, like Avatar, the next four of them, it has a billion do a literal $1 billion budget between them.
You already know it's gonna suck.
Yeah, but like, you know, that movie does that does not mean the movie's going to be good.
Yeah.
That
Oh, I was thinking
that's
like The
not.
Last Airbender, like, because that movie sucked.
Yeah, but yeah,
Yeah,
like,
Avatar.
it's not a. That's not. That doesn't mean shit. All
Yeah.
right, like.
Money does not equate to quality, nor does effects.
Yeah, and neither does. You know, in that case, money is better effects, right?
Yeah.
That's how it works. It doesn't. No correlation. It
It's how
needs
you use
to.
it.
Undertale is a good example of that, right? Undertale is not a impressive game by all standards, and probably would have been a worse game if it looked like a AAA game.
Yeah. I'm so tired of seeing things that look all the same.
Yeah.
The uniformity is the death of any medium. So, on that subject of everything we just talked about, especially with otoMADs in the past and the future, let's start to bring this home. I want to know what you think is the future of the genre, not just for gotchi, but just for you know, we talked about how the internet's evolved, how YouTube and all these platforms are changing, as well as how
Yeah.
collab culture is. So, what do you see as the future?
I think this as a medium will never die, in my opinion, because it branches out far enough. So, you know, back in the day, animutations, I don't know if you remember those or know what those are. It's where a lot of old Flash makers, they started their shit. There's, you know, this Flash shit posting from back in the day. And that died out because it was just the humor did. But MAD and otoMAD and ytpmv is music, and it basically pushes into like DJing and sampling. So I feel like, and it's always existed, right? Like you've heard samples like back in the, like way back, you know, where they're sampling audio for pitch, or they're sampling sayings or rhythm. It's, you know, it's like, you know, just a radio, you know, understand, you know, like it still works in the same vein. It's a sampling, you're sampling. And so I feel like it'll never die. Once people realized it was a thing that could be done, and even in like I said, it's always existed, you know, way before the internet as a form of medium, or maybe people were fucking around, and it never showed up anywhere, but it existed. I think it'll always exist. As long as a platform doesn't destroy it. And I feel like it'll evolve in some ways, but also stay the same. I mean, it has, right? People have gone on from the YTPMV stuff to just remixing kind of like the GIF videos, like the dumbass pants videos and the duck video that I did, I suppose. Which was just me as a creative outlet. And then, you know, it'll evolve in other ways. Siva Garner, you know, that is basically the exact same thing. It's 100% the exact same thing. Except you're sampling one song with another song. So you're turning X song into Flintstones or X song into Undertale. It's the same concept for the most part, except on a deeper level. And I think a lot of people will do it for a while and then they'll move on. And it'll either completely leave them behind, or they'll become musicians or something like
Right,
that,
they'll find a
right?
way to either incorporate it into their future or they'll just leave it as a skill they know.
If they enjoyed it enough, right? Because a lot of people, they turn into musicians. Deep Rich musician, Moi musician. A lot of people from Siva are early YTPMVers musicians. Some of them are DJs. I know a few DJs, you know, from this and that. And then on the Japanese side, a lot of them, they own studios now. You
Yeah, it's
know,
crazy. It's insane to see like that they really went that far with it.
yeah, because I mean, because you get that taste, right? It's like the kid who bought the little piano keyboard as a kid, and he just start fucking around, and he's like, and then, you know, it starts a little bit more. Like Evo is a really great example, where it was just a whole bunch of fucking nerds who really love fighting games. Now it's this big old thing because it was just the same assholes who really like fighting games, but then they realize a whole bunch of other people like fighting games, and then, like, you know, oh, the companies would put money into it because it promotes their fighting games, and now Evo is Evo, and esports, it's esports is esports. I mean, is it directly correlated from Evo? No, but it's related.
Yeah.
Will otoMAD become anything more than that? Probably not, unless everyone gets together and we create a record studio for real music, which could possibly happen from SIVA. Not saying that it's even in the works or anything like that, but like SIVA is a 100 people deep or something. That is a lot of people to create something.
Right.
They could potentially make a real ass album and
Yeah,
sell
yeah,
it for
yeah.
real money because there's enough people, right? And all it takes is an idea and people who are interested, and it becomes a thing.
Yeah.
And so I feel like it'll exist forever. Like I said, as long as there's a platform for it, if YouTube changes in such a way that nukes into the ground, it might disappear and come back, or you'll see it every now and then where it's a random Reddit post.
Yeah.
You see it already, right? Like, it's people who have never heard of ytpmv or otoMAD, and they shitpost the. They're trying to meme, but they can't edit, and they're on the top level internet Facebook posts. But they're like, haha, like, I'm gonna edit this in such a way, and it's a ytpmv, but it doesn't get any farther. You know what I'm talking about, right? You've seen it, where it's just like, I could tell you're like super normie internet, and you've edited this just like a ytpmv, but like it's completely off pitch, and like everything is bad about it.
Right, and if they're still in the cave, they haven't seen what's really out there, but they also don't need to because their audience is just like them, you know?
Yeah, and but you need people who do it as well. Like ytpmv would never have existed without people who created a community around it, and YouTube
Absolutely.
allowed that to thrive. Otherwise, it would be the one-off video every now and then, and the three or four channels that only do that. It's like the people who have those pneumatic crushing videos where they crush it with the big ass pneumatic thing.
Right.
Like, there's no community around that. It's just people who do it. Maybe the five guys who do it, all know each
Yeah,
other
they
and
meet up
they talk
every year.
about,
Yeah.
yeah, and they crush some things.
Yeah.
But, and I still care deeply about this subculture. I don't talk about it a lot, because I'm fucking busy, but I care about it a lot. I want to do tutorials on it, because it's easy, kind of, sort of, and it's not that hard, on the surface level. Once you get into the deep ass things, I've been doing it for 10 years, so I can hear audio in crazy ways and all this. That's
Yeah.
different. But getting into Reaper and hitting shift 09 and scrubbing audio and stretching it is four hotkeys, and you're 90% of the way there. The rest is art.
Nice.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, I guess that's really that is the future, just what people make of it and whether or not the platforms change.
Yeah.
What it, and I guess probably the last thing I want to know about is just the current collaboration climate, because I've seen there are more, especially here in the West, there are so many more collaborations coming out during the year. And I mean, they're not all from the same source necessarily. I mean, they'll be from like this one's McDonald's, this one's Old Spice, this one's whatever. But there's almost like an oversaturation of new collaborations happening, and it almost, I want to say, devalues them because there are so many at once. They're less of like a special occasion, and also because I don't think the vetting is as rigorous. People are just kind of jumping on without having gotten their feet wet in the actual individual production work. So I wanted to know your thoughts on that, because maybe you have a different opinion than me, or maybe the same.
I definitely disagree on vetting as much as I probably would have said differently when I was still in collabs, because that's going to create that elitism, whereas like, yeah, I'm on this team, no one fucking else can be on this team. And it's hard to get your foot in the door in life.
Right.
Let's not add it to our joke collab. And having the person who like is unknown is fine, because it will take more pressure off the collab. Where, like I said, you're not there's no money at stake. This is not a Hollywood production. Like, have fun with it. The thing with the whole bunch of collabs, maybe it devalues it, but maybe that's the future, in its own way. But it shows that it's one thing, and that's people are passionate
Yeah.
enough to work in things like that. There was a lot of collabs back in the day, maybe before you got started as well. They were different, though. They're the YTPMV style collabs, right? There was the one where it was one song that was cut into many parts. There was a fuckload of those, dude.
Oh yeah, and it would just be the one song, like name of song, and then collab.
Yeah, then cut into chunks, right?
Yeah, and it, or they'd even loop the same part over and over and just see how different people approached it.
Yeah, I feel like it's probably a good thing. because I think it'll show people how they work as well. And I think it's a good it's it lets people know that the people who are in the IWF and all that are inspiring people.
Yeah.
And that's important. To inspire people to start and make stuff. I think that's the most important. That's where I got started. And that's where I think a lot of the people in IWF got started was being inspired by the collabs themselves
Right.
on one end of the spectrum or the other, where like I was inspired to get really good from the Danjiri collabs
Right.
and so I pushed myself and a lot of people kind of in the past, probably not so much anymore. A lot of people in my opinion, have overshadowed me in skill. Looked up to me to get to that level or this and that in those ways. And a lot of the people, they saw the later Danjiri and they wanted to do it, or they saw the early IWFs, or the only one, which is 2013.
Yeah. Not
And maybe
even
that
5 minutes
inspired
of
them.
power.
Yeah, and then or the Octagon ones, right? And then there was a big dry spell from like from
There is a
14 to
huge gap,
16.
yeah.
Yeah. Which makes me laugh because I was in all those ones, wasn't I?
That's pretty
Yeah, I
funny.
was.
That is quite funny.
Yeah, I was, motherfucker.
Well, why do you think I think you're an authority on the matter? You've
Yeah,
got
I
the
mean, yeah,
experience, you know?
IWF 2013, first Octagon collab, second Octagon collab, and then the rise of the new IWFs. Yeah, huh? Because I can't really think of any Western ones in between there. And I was always into the collabs really hard, right? Like
Yeah.
I pushed really hard for the second Octagon collab. The first one was not my doing, but I was in it, and then I really wanted more. I wanted to emulate the Japanese collab really bad because I loved it. I
Right.
wanted more of it, and I wanted practice, and I wanted to do it. And so, I pushed harder for it, and so that was second Octagon collab. And then, is it around the same time or before or something? That's when first IWF came out, and that was, it was a thing. It was fun. Still friends with a lot of them. I mean, that's the tight-knit group of a few people.
Right.
Damn.
Time flies, huh?
Yeah. And, but yeah, I feel like the big collabs. I'm trying not to like go back on what I said, right? Because it's like, yeah, you don't overwork it, but you're also inspiring people.
Yeah.
But just like balance it, right? Like don't overdo it. Just do it as well as it needs to be done. Because like to be honest, the most inspiring collab that I've seen in a while was the last Octagon collab, and that was not visually impressive, to say the least. But that didn't need to be. I
Right,
don't
no,
look
it was
down on it,
exactly what it should
and
have been.
exactly. I don't go there and cross my hands and go, these visuals suck. Like I don't think that way in the least.
Yeah.
I'm just like this collab fucking rules.
Yeah.
Because I don't see that it needs to be pushed any farther because it hit a happy medium
Yeah.
of where it needs to be.
Not
Like I said,
overproduced.
you can't in your head think of what Undertale should look like as a AAA game.
Nah.
And that's exactly where you need to push your things. As like a skill level and all that, you need to know the boundaries, not look at it needs to look like fucking Call of Duty Modern Warfare, it's perfect, and this is a Pixar movie. If that's the first fucking thing you're going for, you've already set yourself up for failure.
Yeah.
Is that it needs to be amazing looking? No. No. Think about what it needs to look like and how it needs to move. And if you feel like it needs to go there, push it there. If you don't do it. It's gonna suffer.
Damn, that's valuable insight, I think, especially if anyone listening to this wants to work on this kind of content. You're listening to one of the veterans. If there ever was one of East and West, take it to heart.
It's for everything too, man. I'm telling you, that's not just like everything that I've said about art tonight
Yeah.
is not mad specific. It's it can be everything.
applied. Absolutely.
I've learned most of my disciplines and like life skills from MAD that has applied to everything else that I've worked on, you know.
Absolutely.
It's important.
Awesome, man. Well, I think we're just about at the end of this. So if there's anything you wanted to add or talk about before we wrap things up, anything on your mind?
Yeah, I think I have some words of wisdom. And that is, you can do anything you want artistically, no matter what and how unachievable it seems. Just go at it and do it. It's a time thing. We mentioned way at the start of this. All my first videos completely off pitch. There was no video editing whatsoever. It was the raw video clips playing and blanking to, black footage because nothing was behind it and then back. And that's where I started. And if you look up to the big collab people or any person in VFX or 3D or anything like that, everyone starts at the same, which is nothing. We're all born, we learn how to walk, we learn how to talk, we learn how to eat. There isn't this like you're gifted, the lightning bolt didn't come down through the ceiling and hit you in the head and go, you're gonna be fucking good at 3D. You just gotta sit there and have fun with it. You're not gonna learn if you hurt yourself doing stuff. It's like if you want to draw and you're drawing until your wrist hurts, you're not gonna do much better once your wrist hurts, or you're playing your guitar until your fingers bleed. You're not gonna be playing guitar very much better once your fingers start bleeding. Like, just take your time and have fun. And if you trying to learn it is not fun, maybe you don't want to learn it that bad. It's like people wanting to lose weight. If it's harder to lose weight than the effort to put in, then obviously that amount of effort isn't is more than the amount that you want to lose weight. Or like I like to say, never loan a friend money and expect to be paid back, and then also know if they run away with that money that your friendship was worth less than the $100. Kind of the same thing. So you could do anything that you want, and I know it's tough as an artist, but if I could do it, and trust me when I say that I'm the least likely to do it, you guys can fucking do it too.
You got me, Nana.
You got me, Nana.
That's awesome, man. Well, thanks a lot for that wisdom. And I hope that it sticks for everyone who heard it. Well, I mean, let's wrap things up properly. Where can they check you out? Where's your stuff, and what are you working on right now that you'd love to talk a little bit about?
You can find me on YouTube. I'm sure the links are at the below if they're not put them there.
I
it's
can't, bro. They're gonna filter the video.
No, you have to put it after all the other things. No, you can link it into the YouTube,
Yeah, I'll link to
into
the YouTube channel for
YouTube.
sure.
No, yeah. YouTube, Mountain Dew, MowtenDoo. Twitter, same thing, same handle. Those are my only two places that I'm on the internet at the moment. I do have a Twitch channel. I don't stream very often. I don't really stream, don't go to it. I might stream 3D later though, at one point. I have a Patreon, meh. If you want to give me free money, go for it, same name. What I'm working on, shit all. I'm freelancing. At the moment, can't talk about them. I signed NDAs. I have a good chunk of videos that I've been dreaming about. And I really, really do mean dreaming. I have one that I was gonna release at one point, but I blew my computer up this year.
Oh,
That
man.
was cool. Yeah, now I have 64 gigs of RAM though, and a Threadripper that has 24 cores. Fuck yeah. Dude, 64 gigs of RAM is no joke. And don't be like, oh man, yeah, you got all this computer stuff, like you spent all this money, like this is a work computer, man. This is not a hobbyist play
Nah, this
video
is your
games
life.
computer. This is the I need to spend this much money on a computer or I'm going to suffer.
It's tax deductible, bro.
It is, yeah. But yeah, no, I'm not, I'm dreaming. If you want the best answer, what I'm working on right now, I'm dreaming.
Beautiful.
And I'm dreaming hopefully the most fun thing I've ever dreamt.
That's awesome, man. Well, thanks a lot for taking the time to have this conversation. This is definitely, of all the series of conversations I've had in this kind of video, this is no doubt the longest one.
I told you
You did. No,
beforehand.
and I came in, I've been preparing for this mentally, knowing like that you're gonna be sitting there for 3 to 4 hours. And that's exactly what we did. So there's no shortcomings of promises being met. But I appreciate it. It's been really fun.
Yeah, thank you for having me, man. And this definitely was a lot of fun.
Awesome. Well, everybody, thanks for tuning in and listening. Be sure to check out Mountain Dew, Mountain. Check out Mountain Dew on his different channels as he described, and keep dreaming. And we'll see you next time. Thanks for listening.
Later, y'all.